My name's Lance Martin. I'm the broker owner of Coldwell Banker, Town and Country. It's hard to believe, Mike. This is our sixth annual market forecast that we've done. So, wow, just crazy. Crazy that we're here for another year. So I've been told that this is a good problem to have, and I do think it's a good problem to have. But for those of you that got here earlier on time, and you've got a chair, so that's good. We have a lot of tickets out there, and we've got a lot of sponsors, which you guys have seen the scroll. Mountain West, thank you guys. Saw your name pop up. Give a hand. And a few others, which we'll be mentioning. As we roll through the program today. But at any rate, we've had more interest in our market forecast event this year than I think we've had in ever. So that's either a testimony to we're putting on a good event and have great speakers, or maybe we've just got some people out there that are really, really wondering, what the heck's going on with our market here this year. So at any rate, I'm pretty excited. Who's in charge of the feedback here? Linda, is that you back there?
Yeah.
Are you working on that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. As long as somebody's working on it, I feel better. Okay. Linda, by the way, with the Double Tree is rocking it. So thank you very much. I do not have a PowerPoint just because from a time standpoint, we want to make sure we give our speakers as much time as they possibly can to present to you guys. And I don't think anybody really came here this morning to hear me speak anyway. Having said that, I'll give you what I think's been going on in the last year since we met last year. 2016 generally was a pretty good year, and I'm putting this from the context of a broker who does mostly residential real estate and property management. We saw our numbers improve. Nothing fantastic. We didn't set any records, but we certainly had a better 2016 than we had a 2015. The fourth quarter ultimately was a lot stronger than I had expected. I'm always fearful when we start to get into August and September because we start to see listings decrease and we start to see open escrows decrease. And then, of course, we start to see, hey, Charlene, and we start to see fewer closings. Having said that, October, November, and December were pretty darn good. So I'm not sure if you guys have a similar experience, which, by the way, let's take a moment here. Raise your hand if you are a realtor in one form or another selling houses. Okay, so that's probably, I'm going to say, 80% of the room. Any commercial brokers out here? A couple commercial guys? Okay, I'm interested to see I don't know if Bruce has anything on commercials. I got a little bit of a sneak peek on a few of the PowerPoints, and there's a couple of insights, if you will, or at least some opinions on what's going on in the commercial market. Who's in the lending title escrow business? All right, fantastic. Give me a hand. So at any rate, I always kind of gauge our business based upon what the loan officers and the title officers are telling me. And I tend to ask everybody the same question when I see them is, how's business? So if it's, and normally I don't really care too much about what closed last month. I'm always interested in how many title orders did you open last month or this week? How many loan applications did you take last month or last week? As opposed to, I had a great month, I killed it, I closed a whole bunch of escrows. But anyway, I'm generally hearing the same thing, so we'll kind of see. We'll have plenty of time for a Q&A as well. The format's going to be kind of the following. We're going to bring Bruce Norris up here in just a minute or two. I'm not going to do the bio because I don't want to cut into Bruce's time. But we're going to have Bruce come up. He's going to speak for approximately a half hour. I've already told him if he needs more time, then he can take more time. In between Bruce and Iddo, I don't think I've seen Iddo in the room yet this morning. But Iddo, everybody's back by popular demand. I mean, we had the same four speakers this year that we had last year. I've given Iddo a little bit more time, actually quite a bit more time this year because we crammed him into a pretty, I think, a 15 or 20 minute window last year, and everybody came up and said, geez, give us more Iddo. So Iddo will be here. In between Bruce and Iddo, we're going to have some of our sponsors come up and give away some cookies or bottles of wine or something like that. And then after Iddo, we'll do the same thing before we bring up John Husing. I've seen John's PowerPoint. He emailed it in yesterday. And again, I don't want to preempt it, so we'll let it speak for itself. And then Chris Thronberg is going to take us home. If, for those of you that are still standing, we'll do a Q&A when we're done. There is a, matter of fact, I think you, it was just on the screen just a second ago before that slide. We'll, at some point, we'll get the phone number and we'll blast it on the wall over here. We're going to do the same thing we did last year. We will want to ask questions. We will pass around some mics, but for those of you that don't want to take the mic or we just have a, too much of a demand, you'll be able to text some questions into a number. It's 855-855-something, and you can text those questions in. So depending upon if any of the speakers wrap up a little earlier than their allocated time, we might be able to take a couple questions from the audience. It just really kind of depends on time. We're not going to take any breaks in between these speakers. So there's not going to be a 10 or 15 minute break at any point in time. So for those of you that, you know, can't hold your coffee, just please be respectful and quiet. Don't make us get up and scream at you from the back of the room because you're talking too loud. So at any rate, super excited that we're here. We actually have about 600 people that RSVP'd for this event. This room only holds about 350. So we'll see. Yeah. So we'll kind of see how that, we'll see how that shakes out here. So at any rate, like I say, that's my 7-minute introduction. I want to thank everybody. Oh, and just in case I forget later, because I very well may forget later, I really want to take an opportunity to recognize Ingrid. Ingrid, say hi. And Stacy as well. At the risk of not mentioning all of the other people that work at Coldwell Banker Town and Country in the lobby right now, which I won't because there's too many of them out there, but Ingrid and Stacy, they've truly made this their event and they do all the hard work to make this happen. I just kind of show up and got a reason to buy a new suit. So anyway, okay, we're going to go ahead and get started. So is Bruce, are you mic'd up, my friend?
I am.
Okay, then I'll get your PowerPoint queued up.
Good morning. Thank you for coming. You got some really smart people this afternoon or later this morning. I'm looking forward to hearing what they have to say. The difference between a lot of the speakers, I mean, they have PhDs in economics, and I've been getting my butt kicked around for 30 years in this industry. And to me, that's a very valuable thing because when I look at a chart, it means something to me. I remember 1990 really well. So if an economist looks at 1990 and thinks that's not a dangerous year, I can go, well, you know, I beg to differ. In 1989, I had the bright idea of building 7 custom homes in Palm Springs. I had done really well in the mid-80s to 89, and I thought, gosh, real estate is something I really have a great grasp on. Everything I touch turns to gold. Let's do some more. And I got very aggressive. It turned out to be at the wrong time. So I got done with 7 custom homes in June of 1990 in Palm Springs in a gated area, and I thought this is going to be a home run. We actually bought a golf cart that held 8 people and the driver, and I ran a full-page ad. I thought we would be slammed with activity. No one answered the ad, not one call. It's when you know you're in trouble. I had 7 $3,000 a month payments that I had to make until I resolved the problem. That was fun. And my last closing of those 7 homes, I wrote about a $62,000 check to make up the difference in the shortfall. That's called a personal short sale. And you kind of remember that stuff. In 1995, my son Aaron graduates from high school. So just 5 years later, coming off of a market that felt like 2005, where everything was exciting, in 1995, he graduates from high school. I buy him a Honda Civic for $15,700, and the only reason I remember that is 2 days later, I buy a house in Riverside, a 3-bedroom house, for $13,300. And I remember thinking, what the heck? Plus, the house was on a VA list, so it was for sale for $15,000. It went through the time period where no owner-occupant made an offer on it. It went to the extended list, and I was the only bidder. Now, that's when you start looking around going, am I stupid or what? Why am I the only guy showing up for a house for $15,000? I get it at the maximum discount, and it rents for $500, and they already fixed it. That's a day where you go, oh, maybe I'm doing something stupid. And so that was the day I realized it's not enough to know how to do the buy-sell business. It's better to know when. There's a timing element into things. And as a realtor, man, isn't that true? How many REO agents are they in the room right now? There's not a lot of need for them. Doesn't mean it won't come back, but it's really smart to know when it's coming because you, those people make a lot of money during those cycles. So that's what we're known for. We're known for taking a look at things and saying, okay, this is what's coming next. And we're going to talk specifically about this year, where we are in the current market. So to get to a peak price, I'm going to share with you a number of charts. And one of the things you need is you need sales momentum. So if you take a look at, does that look like sales momentum? And does that look like sales momentum? And these are all the way back to the big three runs in price we had. Is this sales momentum when you compare it to all that? No, it's flat. It's very difficult to get to a peak price when you have no exuberance in the marketplace. So what's interesting, it's all relative. You guys, and Lance just got up and said that last year was a pretty good year. But it was a pretty good year, not a great year. And to have prices get to a point where you reach a breaking point, you need sales to be really strong, and you don't have them. So what's interesting, what's the main reason given why sales aren't strong? No inventory. Well, we're going to debunk that one a little later, because that's why I like charts. Okay, so if you don't have a lot of sales, maybe the problem is the capacity of the buyer in relationship to the current lending programs. So right now, if you have a FICO score that's under 600, FHA is much less likely to give you a loan than they used to. So at one point, back in 2008, 47.5% of their business was that category of borrower, and now it's about 18%. So it's a very big difference in who's getting in at the first rung of being a buyer. And so when you talk about sales, you really need this category of lending. You need, and the title of the chart is, you need lenders to say yes to when not capable buyers. It just took me about 3 months to get a credit line. And when you look at the financials that they were looking at, you go, I wonder what is taking so long? It's just the way lending is right now. It's very funny, but it's not very helpful to volume of sales. The share of first-time buyers, because of that, is down considerably. So our first-time buyers right now are equivalent to when rates were completely nuts. And now they're at, I know we've gone up, right? Where are we all the way up to now? 4.25? Oh, no, that's terrible. How many of you have customers going to wait till it gets back into threes? See, what can happen is that you have people that go, oh, I missed the boat on the threes, but I'm not going to miss the boat on the fours. And if you have a history of, like me, when I got in the business, I refinanced my residence to become an investor. And the timing was not perfect. That was 1981. It was 17.5% fixed. And very smart people told me, well, you never see under double digits again, ever. And then for the next 30 years, they go down until they hit the threes, and you go, oh my gosh. So maybe there's the good thing never to say never. You may just see some strange interest rates, and we'll talk about that right to the end of my talk. So first-time buyers are not being able to buy their share of properties because there isn't a lot of that inventory, and the builders are not able to build that inventory. That's one of the problems. It doesn't pencil. If you're a builder and you buy a lot for 80 grand and you have 50 grand in fees, how are you going to build a starter home? It doesn't work. It's not profitable, so you build something else. You need trustee sales. Again, to get to the peak of the price, you need trustee sales to be nearing their lows for the cycle. So this chart looks like, well, we're really a lot lower than we were. We're not as low as we've been in the past. But here's an interesting thing about this chart and kind of a lot of charts. Did we have anything that prevented foreclosures this time in great numbers? Yes. So for the first time ever, when somebody fell behind, we had a collective policy that said, that's okay. We'll just let them sit there. We're not going to foreclose on them. We'll let them sit there for about 2 or 3 years or 4 years. And that was our collective policy. That had never happened before. As a matter of fact, in 1995, the only year that the trustee sales actually went down and then went back up Lenders didn't foreclose on people when they passed a law that said if you're 100 days late and you have Fannie Mae loan, you have to file an NOD. Did we do that in 2008 and 9? No way. And the reason was the inventory of what was for sale was dominated by lender inventory, which is very dangerous to price. So in 2009, in San Bernardino, you had 80-some percent of the inventory listed as it was an REO. The prices were in free fall. 50 properties were for sale for every $1,000 price increment. How's that for a buyer's market? So the lender doesn't take your offer for that property, who cares? There's another 49 at the same price. Okay, so this time the chart looks healthier than it is. You have some people that would have been in foreclosure that have loan balances and payments that may adjust. I don't think any of this is going to be a huge problem, but this chart isn't completely as safe as it appears. You need construction of new homes strong and drive both employment and migration. Again, the idea is to get to a peak price. So I'm starting to hear, yeah, they're building everywhere. Does it look like we're building everywhere by if you look at a chart? I mean, we're still in depression mode, to be honest with you. This is California. So look at the lines. Again, these go back a long ways. We're nowhere close to 1980. It's hard for me to see it. 1981, 82. You know what a construction loan interest rate was back then? 20.5. So the current lending environment, it's at 4.25, and you're building a lot more than you were 4 years ago. And so you can sort of tell lies with charts. Could I say, oh, yeah, building in California has doubled in the last 5 years? You go, yeah, wow, that's really great. Then you look at the chart for a longer period of time and go, oh, that's still not so good. Now, Riverside County is really one of those areas that gets affected by building not doing so well. So there's our chart. So you say, well, yeah, but in Riverside, we're building a lot. No. We're building at 20% of our past. 20%. And if you think there's a lot of exuberance, the yellow line or the gold line is future projects for land creation, creating building lots. What's the builder saying? I don't like the environment. It's not going to pencil. There's so many barriers to getting a yes answer, I'm going to pass. That's a scary thought. Because for Riverside County, this is a big driver of migration and employment and on. The list goes on and on. It affects a lot of businesses. And it doesn't look like the builders or the land developers are going, yeah, let's create some tracts of lots for the future. They're really hesitant about that. When you see a lot of activity in construction, there's a good chance those lots were bought for nothing 6 years ago. I know people that bought lots for 10 grand a piece that still can't pencil a project, and they're up in Hesperia and Victorville and Lancaster and Palmdale. You can't pencil it. I bought lots for 3 grand at the last downturn, and I couldn't do a project for 3 years waiting for prices to increase. So there are times when you can't even give the lots away. In the 90s, we were offered something like 50 building lots for free by a city. The only speculation was you had to build on it that year because they wanted to get the fees and the taxation, but they wouldn't pencil. I could buy an REO for half of the product cost. So why would I do that? So there are times where it doesn't make sense, and we're there right now. It doesn't look like the builder's really optimistic. How long does it take to say, I think I'll buy that parcel land and create building lots? Is it 3 months? It's more like 2 or 3 years. And so that's the problem, is you don't have the clarity of saying, I feel really safe where I'm going to land 3 years from now. You just go, I'm not going to do it. You need an economy doing well enough to encourage household formation. So this is by quarter, but last year, what was our GDP for the entire year? Under 2%, which is interesting because it was paired with the interest rates that we have and also unemployment, which would be considered full employment. So we got full employment, and we're clipping along at below 2% GDP. Something's not right. If that's the best we can do, something's not right. You need owners with lots of equity to move up. And so this is improving. We actually have this number, 175 grand. When you sell a typical California home, you end up with $175,000, which helps the move-up market. What's interesting is what we haven't done this time. This is a chart that's a little bit harder to read, but it tells an interesting story. This is equity withdrawal. So take a look at the history of that. We were taking out enough to make up about 8 or 10% of our annual income every year out of our homes at the peak market last time. And this is the first year, 2016, that we've taken out anything. So what has occurred is either lending has said you can't get an equity line, or we actually have people self-moderating saying, I don't want to borrow it. I'm going to be more cautious. And that's probably what's going on is you just go, yeah, last time I did this, debt got me in a lot of trouble. So all of the stuff that I'm looking at, you know, it doesn't look like we're reaching this peak price. You need inventory for sale to be below 3 months. We're hovering around 4 or so. There's not that urgency. If you're in San Francisco a year or two ago, you had your inventory in days, in a couple of weeks, and you had prices that were already nuts, and then they went up 25% on top of a nutty price. Why? Because inventory was barely there. And so when inventory is too low and you have demand, your prices escalate, and the guy that owns the property is just like, ah, I'm so glad I own something. Unsold inventory, this is a chart that I wanted to kind of dispute this thought that inventory is our problem with sales. This is our inventory. Take a look at this here, this little stretch of years. Inventory is around 2 months. So if inventory is about 4 months, twice this, then how did we accomplish this sales? So that big pile of sales came off of inventory that was half the level that we currently have. Does that make sense? So when you say, oh yeah, we don't have enough inventory, no, you don't have enough capable demand. You might have demand, and I heard you got 35 people showing up to open houses, then you should have a free-for-all in price increases. If the demand is that strong, we should be exploding in price. Well, they can't get a yes answer yet. The day they do, well, then that'll be a different game. But right now, they want in and can't get in. That's still true. Okay? You need the mix of sales to be to sales to trustee sales to be near record lows, and we're getting to that ratio. And why that's significant is there's just no motivated inventory for sale. And this is, as an investor, I look at these charts and I like when I see what we were back in 2009. Look at this. 60% of the sales were REOs. 10% were short sales. 70% of the time when a sale closed, another buyer didn't emerge and walk to another transaction. It was a zero. That had never happened before. So recently, I was interviewing the chief economist of Fannie Mae, Doug Duncan. And I don't mean recently, it's really almost a year and a half ago now. When I interviewed him, I looked at the quarterly report for the first quarter of 2015. And in that report, it said that the mix of sales in Florida was causing 25% of the entire losses for this country for Fannie Mae. They were in 2009. Why? Because they have a four-year foreclosure process. I got excited. That's opportunity. I called up my best friend and said, look for building lots. There has to be somebody that has lots they do not want. And within 2 days, we were in escrow. So this chart is telling me that we have the capacity, if we get lending world to be more aggressive, you do have the capacity to have a strong price movement. That's a big if, okay? Signs you're peaking in price. I'm going to quickly go through this because time-wise, I want to make sure we be respectful of other people. There's a spread that usually closes and then intersects, and the inventory that's existing actually gets to be more expensive than new houses. It's only happened in 89, it happened in 05, and the spread right now is huge. So the new price home is over the maximum in 2006 and 7. So we're already reached that very high price. The existing home is below it, and the spread is about as big as it's ever been. So this time, that intersection to happen probably will have to have the new home price decline, or we'd have to see a heck of a run, but that's what normally happens. Look at that brown line and how it runs to catch the gold line at a certain point. So we'll just have to We'll have to see. But if the spread is that big, it tells me we're not close to a peak in price, because that's not happening. The affordability historically gets down to a number that's around 17%, and then there's a domino effect that happens. And it happened in 80, 89, 2005, 2006 and 7, we were below 17%, but we all kind of figured out how we got there. It was on BS, basically. We did loans we shouldn't have done. And so affordability got kind of tossed out the window. And now we're at about 32% affordability, which mimics very safe years in our past. If you're concerned about, well, we're approaching a peak, well, you'd be talking about 2002, 87, 77, 78. We're plenty of room left to go up. Now, if we don't go up, then our ending will be very different and much safer, because you won't have anything exaggerated. You won't have a bunch of people that got in. Remember those 4 years of crazy sales? You won't have that group of people that got in with the nothing down, with the phony application, not knowing what they're doing, et cetera, et cetera. So if you had an ending, it would be much more mild. This is a mudometer chart. Mudometer basically is a math calculation that says every year, what percentage, if you were buying the median price home and the going interest rate, what percentage of income would it take from you? And it's at the peak markets, we get into the 55% range of what you make, up to 60%. And that's usually for various reasons. But right now we're at 42. So 42%, 41%, something like that, we're not in any danger zone here. This is like an appraiser, by the way, looking at comps and saying, okay, the affordability number is very safe. The mudometer is very safe. The spread between new and existing is very safe. The comps are telling me the same story. We're not close to a peak in price. At least a peak in price that's going to cause damage, a bunch of foreclosures, etc. One of the calculations we did is we actually took the median, the payment rather, that would have emerged in 2005 in the first quarter, which we thought was the realistic peak of the last market, which would have mimicked 89 and 80 at 17% affordability. And what we did is we produced a monthly payment and projected that in the future and said, this is the ending point for Riverside. We're going to end price, because the payment can vary, right? What if interest rates tomorrow morning are 5 or 6? Payment? Okay, well, that's kind of what this comp does, is deal with the payment structure. And we say, okay, if we're applying a certain interest rate, how much room do we have to go up? And on the bottom, you'll see that in Riverside County, there's still plenty of room for upside. And even if you have higher interest rates going up, going out to 4 and 5 or 6%, you have room. Is that true everywhere? The answer is no. If you're in San Francisco, you're already over the last payment by a long shot. Do I consider that a speculative market? Yes. Do they consider that a speculative market? No. Do you ever think that is a speculative market where you're in the middle of it and making, you know, 50 grand a month on what you own? It's hard. It's very hard to say, yeah, I've had enough of that. I'm going to sell. It's hard to do, man. It is. So Riverside looks like we have a safe spread. California median price versus the U.S. median price as a ratio. We're at a pretty high number. We've only been in this category twice. We get to a point where we're double or more the national price. And what generally can happen then is you say, okay, gosh, let's say if I'm 64 years old, which I am, and say, if I sold my house in Riverside for $1 million, and I moved to Florida, I could buy the same house for 400 grand, bank the 800 grand and retire, and have no state tax. I think I might do that. And so when that spread is too big, you get that. You get people going, okay, well, I'm out of here. It makes perfect sense, okay? So the bigger the spread, the more likely it is you're going to have some exiting for that reason. California median household income to California median price. So you take your price, divide it by your income, you get a multiple. So historically, you know, you can get all the way up at 10 in the crazy years we had in, say, 05, 06, 07. That's not really realistic. So we're at a pretty high multiple right now, courtesy of what? Interest rates. This is on the backs of low interest rates. That's why the multiple is possible. What happens when you have interest rates that are pretty high? Oh, you have a very low multiple. So the future of interest rates is really important to California at this particular time, because if it got aggressively upwards, the math wouldn't work. So you'd have some issues, okay? So here's our interest rate journey. So I got involved right when the peak happened. Told you about the buy at 17.5, and ever since then it's kind of gone down with a little bit of up and then down and up. So now what's interesting is if you could foresee the next 30 years, is the chart going to go the other way? Wouldn't that be scary stuff, huh? Okay. For the short term, say within 2 years, we just finished a report, gave it to a audience of 435 people that packed a room, and the title of the report was 2% interest rates and $40 trillion in debt. And I think that in the next 2 years, we'll have a recession, and it'll be really interesting hear what the people say that the economists coming up, because I'm very interested in what their take is on that, because we will, if we don't have a recession in the next 2 years, we'll literally set an all-time record for not having a recession, which I'm not buying. In the event that you have a recession, what happens is they adjust the Fed fund rate to counter that. Every time, guess how big? 4%. So what's the Fed fund rate right now? Is it a half? About a half. So let's say you get a bunch of raises, you know, we're all freaking out. Oh, they're going to raise, and they raise it 0.25%. The year I was in the business, by the way, got in the business, you know how many times they raised the Fed fund rate in that year? 21 times. We're freaking out about one raise. What do we do? Okay. Let's say they get aggressive and raise all the way to 2% before the recession, and then you have a 4% downside you're going to take away. Are we in negative interest rate territory possibly? Is there any precedence for that around the world, by the way? Lots of it. If you get a minus 2% short term, you probably have a 1% 10-year T-bill. You probably have a mortgage rate that starts with a 2. What's really interesting is you may not have a great real estate market with that environment. You'll have one heck of a busy loan business, right? Everyone in the world will refi, which really is going to be very impactful. Can you imagine refiing starts with a 2? I mean, that's astonishing. But it would also say, you know what, I think I'll just stay. Wouldn't that make people stay? If interest rates went back up to 5, when would you say, well, yeah, I'll swap my 2% for a 5? You'd probably go, no, I think we'll add a room. We'll buy some carpet. We'll stick around. So that's going to be an impactful. But it also would really be, would allow for spendable income to emerge. I mean, if you have a payment that really got that low, then your income, when it grew, you'd have spendable income. And we're going to need it, because there's going to be a need to make up some deficits. That's what the $40 trillion is about. We have locked and loaded. People like me are about to say, you know what, I think I'll collect my Social Security, my Medicare, and you all guys have to pay it, and defined benefit plans and so forth and so on. There's a lot of debt. So it would be nice to have a break and get a 30-year benefit maybe out of a 9-month recession. Wouldn't that be cool? At the same time, by the way, I just went back and spoke in front of Fannie Mae, and one of the things I suggested, two things I suggested, I mean, we were there stumping for investor financing. Can you please get past 10 and go to whatever, 50? Okay, so that's one of the reasons I was there. But I mentioned a loan program that I really think they should implement, because, and you'll see in the next couple of charts, what is inevitably going to occur if they don't. I think that Fannie Mae should do a nothing down loan. And I think it could be perfectly safe. You have to have two caveats. Nothing down loan, the loan is able to be taken over with a simple assumption. People that have some gray hair or been around for a while, there used to be something called a simple FHA assumption, where you didn't call in, you didn't get a pack of papers, you sent in a $45 check and said, Bruce Norris is taking the place of John Smith as the owner of this property, transfer the loan to my name, I'm the new owner, done. In a conversation at a previous meeting in Washington, D.C., I was across from the director of FHA. I said, would you mind if I took over the loan with a simple assumption? He said, I don't have any problem with that. And I said, can I quote you on that? And he laughed. He said, no, we can't make that a policy. But he knows what sense that would make. So let's say you have nothing down loans going out. Would that, by the way, help people buy? They probably can qualify, but they're missing the down payment. What if they don't make a payment? Okay, let's handle it one of two ways. Anybody that will make the payment up can take over the loan. So, will that solve most foreclosures? Yes. Okay, doesn't work. You go all the way to the trustee sale process. The opening bid is the late payment. Has nothing to do with the principal. So you're 6 months behind on a 400 grand loan at 3%. You do the math. How big is the bid? 20 grand? So for 20 grand, you take over the loan. Is the lender safer than they were if they foreclosed on it? Yes. Would you have any foreclosures? You virtually would have no foreclosures, and you'd end up changing the outlook for the chart that's going to happen this way. This is a projection of the ownership percentage of homes going forward. We're going to be, this is John Burns' projection, it's right around 60%. I honestly think we're below 60% in the future because you've got group between 65 and 85 that own a huge percent of the time, over 80%. Who are getting replaced by a group that's 75%, that are being replaced by a group that's 65%, that are being replaced by a group that's less than 50%. So forward, the math is just, okay, you're going to get below 60%. I don't want there to be more than 40% that don't own the space they occupy. The movies I love talk about how valuable it is to walk on floors you own. And I buy that. When I was married at 17, it was a long way before we bought a house. And then when I was 20, I remember the feeling mowing my grass for the first time. I felt like a man. I had a deed in my name. I didn't have one dime worth of equity. None of the windows opened. The toilet flushed in reverse. And it didn't matter, man. I was proud that I had something that was mine. I don't want people not to have that. I think that's important for our country. I really do. But if we don't change lending policies, that's going to happen. And so they need to figure out. And what's frustrating about when you go to Washington, D.C., and the last time the meeting was very interesting to me because this was a different meeting. We have been there two other times. They both sort of felt a little perfunctory, like, yeah, we have to do this. This time, that was very different. They broke off into groups. They came back with really intelligent questions. The problem with Washington is you have to sell it. It can't just make perfect sense. You have to have some way to explain what you're about to do. How are we going to loan investors 50? Is that me? Oh, I have an alarm that's about to go off, I think. I'm trying to stay within my time frame. So they have to explain what they're about to do. How do you explain nothing down? Wouldn't that hit the fan? Oh, here we go again. The Republicans got in, da-da-da. Well, what if it made perfect sense and didn't cause damage and it sent this back up to 65 or 68? How many of you guys own rentals? I'm just curious. How many of you will guarantee rents for 30 years? I mean, isn't that why we own a rental? It's because about January 1st, we're looking and going, think, there's my time. I didn't know what it was on, but I just found out. Okay, well, I was trying to be respectful of everybody behind me. So that's one of the big advantages of owning is that, you know, as your income grows and your payment's stuck and stays there and eventually disappears, wow, what if you don't have a house payment? Would that change your life? Since 28 years old, because I played around with real estate, I owned a house free and clear without debt. Now, I refied it at 17 and a half to become an investor. But, man, as soon as I could get that paid off, I did. There's just something about that that sort of feels really good. There can be a bunch of stuff go on out there, but you come home and you goes, you know, my debt's really pretty contained. So I hope that they create policies where this line doesn't do this, okay? This is the projection. John Burns wrote a book, by the way, Big Shifts Ahead. You guys ought to have it. Just that simple. It's the most brilliant book I've ever read in real estate. It costs $30 or $25 or whatever. It's really insightful. Written by a really good guy, too. So here's their projection on household formation. And look at the dominant renter versus occupant. It's a big deal. The other thing that he pointed out was there's a big shift in where people are going to land. So California is going to get dwarfed by Florida and Texas as far as where people are going. Okay? We got to get our act together. In the report that we just wrote, California is 49th and 50th in every category of tax friendliness, business friendliness, on and on. It's like you have a go away sign at the border. And people eventually just say there's too many of those things to stick around. And we don't want to do that. California is a cool place, but we got to figure out, you know, how to be more attractive to businesses. And we're really not doing that right. Okay, Lance, do you want me to be done, or I'll take some questions if you want, or if you don't want, then that's fine too.
I want you to be done, but you're done.
I'm done.
Oh, it's the last slide. Perfect. Okay, that's what we're going to do. We're going to bring Iddo up in a couple of minutes. Ingrid and Stacy are going to come up and give away a door prize for you, but while we're doing that, let's take advantage of Bruce here for a second. Let's get Bruce again.
Thank you.
Just wrap this. We only have time for maybe two questions here. I see at least one. Can you just yell really loud?
What do you think of the appraisal, the effect of appraisals coming in considerably lower than what?
Yeah, that's very frustrating.
You didn't have the question.
Okay, I'll repeat it.
What sort of impact are prices being had as far as appraisals coming in low, keeping property values down? Is that accurate statement? All right.
Yeah, one thing is very frustrating. I mean, that's just very frustrating because we have that, you know, because we're in the business, we have that, and you're like, you gotta be kidding. It's within the margin of error. You come in at 3%, like you have something to prove. Some 400 grand house is off by 12 grand. Well, the buyer's made a statement, right? That should be honored. And it's very frustrating, and I don't know what else to say, but they're afraid that if they are aggressive and it gets, you know, through the process of after the loan, if it gets somehow lowered by a secondary appraisal, they could lose their appraisal business. And that's what people are afraid. It's just, I don't know how to fix that either. You know, sometimes we go over the top with regulation and it really didn't improve much because now you can't even pick an expert. We had to give you an example. In Palm Springs, we had a property we were going to flip. There was a big difference in where the location was on the golf course. We bought the thing for $500. We had it for sale for $750. The appraiser came in at 1.2 because he didn't look at the comps and say, oh yeah, this is on the inferior side of the whatever. So guess what? The sale closed. But that's how bad an appraiser can be if he's coming in from out of the area. Wouldn't you have been better off getting an expert in Palm Springs? No, we had the guy from Whittier who didn't know anything about the area, and that's a better appraisal. That's crazy.
Okay, we'll do one more question for Bruce, but while Drake's queuing that up, you're the fastest hand in the room. Just by a show of hands real quick, who's having appraisal problems? Low appraisals come in. Okay, I don't see very many hands. Who's not having appraisal problems? Not the same. Okay, who's having appraisals come in, huh? Okay, we'll do one more question for Bruce. Then Stacy and I are going to do a raffle, and then Ido's on deck next. We do have a few chairs that are kind of, I didn't want to interrupt Bruce, rather. So for those of you that are in the back and you really would like to sit down, just during this little raffle, it would be a good time for you to find a chair or maybe scoot in just a little bit. Okay, so we'll take one last question for Bruce before we bring up Iddo.
I'm from Pasadena area.
Yes.
And there's not a lot of inventory. There's a lot of buyers.
Yes.
35 offers, 40 offers on every house. And they're requiring that appraisal contingencies are gone. Mostly want cash even for the primary residence. With that many buyers and that low inventory and the prices continuing to go up, it makes me nervous. Is that a good or bad time to buy?
I wouldn't be an aggressive buyer. I would think that'd be a more speculative market where you have that, because what if that stops? And it will. You know, the day that stops, you'll go back to, okay, what do people actually qualify for? And it won't be that number. So that's what's happened to San Francisco and San Jose, is that you get a price point that it makes no sense to anybody that doesn't want to check. And when those people go away or don't want to, then you have a market adjustment. So I would think that would be too aggressive for my taste to be a buyer. Okay? All right, guys, thank you.
Well, good morning, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, great. This is a fantastic conference. I came here just a few minutes ago, and I had to park about 50 miles away. It's incredible how many people are out here today. What I wanted to talk to you about today is something a little bit different than what you've been hearing. A lot of people, economists, are drilling down to the nitty-gritty of a percentile and basis points on interest rates and what does this do, so forth. What I'll give you today is sort of the broader picture. What is happening in the world? What people think is happening in the world and actually what is happening in the world, which is quite different, and how that may affect our real economy, which obviously has then the residual effect of interest rates, inflation, all of these other factors. So I'll give you sort of the broad picture of what's happening in the world. It's changing very quickly, and I find that very few people quite understand where it's leading us and what is really going on. So I'll talk about some of the big factors that are happening today. Mark Twain said once that it ain't what you don't know that gets you. It's actually what you know ain't so. So a lot of people think they know what's going on. It's not quite exactly what's going on. And there's actually four fundamental shifts that are happening in the world that are changing what's happening in very profound ways. One is the shift from manufacturing to logistics. The second is from menial to technology jobs. The fourth is from subtractive to additive manufacturing. And the fifth is from analog to digital commerce. And I'll talk about those a little bit at a time. So, well, we all heard about international trade and the global economy. Well, what does that really mean? People don't quite realize that there was a huge expansion. Some of you see it in real estate, industrial real estate, and we hear about it on the news all the time. In 2000, it was about a $5 trillion global economy. And within the next 3 years, it will have expanded to $35 trillion. That's huge expansion. That's like twice the United States in that many years in terms of the economy. Our GDP is about $18 trillion. This is twice, like building twice America and all our economy in that period of time, which is huge. And why is trade so important? So for us to be a sustainable nation, meaning that the government has enough income to support the services they provide to us, everybody has a job, we have full employment, we have all the services we all need, we have reasonable interest rates and so forth. The federal government estimates that we need to get to $22 trillion GDP, right, by 2025. But it's predicated on trade accounting for 60% of our GDP. That means we got to get trade right, which means we need to get the underlying infrastructure to get trade right, which is logistics. You heard about this word a lot. And people think it's a warehouse and a truck, but they don't quite understand what it really means for our economy and what really is going on here. So this is huge. So first of all, I know there's a lot of problems in California, but there's one thing that's right about California. We're in the right side of the world, right? Historically, we're in the right side of the world. Used to be the Atlantic century. Most of our trade was with Europe. That was our big trading partner, and therefore the gateway to America was the East Coast. Well, now it's the Pacific century, right? Most of the trade is coming in from Asia. That's where the growing economies are. And therefore, the gateway to America is the West Coast. We're seeing a lot of expansion here. In fact, all of that trade is coming not to the entirety of California. It's predominantly coming to Southern California, what we call the Southern California Golden Triangle. That's Los Angeles, San Diego, the Inland Empire sort of makes this triangle. And this triangle accounts for about $2.5 trillion of trade that's coming in from the Asia, the Asian markets. And it translates to about 42 million TEUs of container equivalent coming from LA and Long Beach, which is huge because that's nearly half of all the goods that come into America come through our little golden triangle out here in Southern California. And this golden triangle is not just any golden triangle. If you made it an independent nation, right? Independent nation from LA to San Diego and the Inland Empire, it would be something like the 7th, 8th largest economy in the world in and of itself. So that's pretty huge. And what's so unique out here in the Inland Empire is that we're within an hour's drive of every major market, right, in this golden triangle, right? But even more importantly, we're within the overnight trucking to the 11 western states. So from this location where we are, we're within, right, 12 hours to a 4.3 trillion dollar GDP, which is the 11 Western states. We're within 24 hours to $7.5 trillion GDP. And of course, we're within basically 2 days to the rest of the United States, which is an $18 trillion GDP, right? Right out here from Southern California. And what does that really mean? So this is the global economies, the big economies, and if you look at the 11 Western states at about $4.5 trillion GDP, if you made the 11 Western states as an independent nation, we will be the third largest economy in the world, right? The United States is first, then we have China, then the 11 Western states. So from right here in the Inland Empire, we're within literally 12 hours of overnight trucking to the third largest economy in the world, within an hour to an hour and a half drive to one of the largest economy, fifth, sixth, seventh largest economy in the world, depending what year it is and what recession is going on, and literally within 2 to 3 days to the largest economy in the world. And we sell houses for $200,000 to $300,000. See, there's a lot, right? There's some mismatch of where we are, what we're doing, and there's factors that are impacting why that is. So it isn't just that it's a great economy, but the way the world goes and the way we've been blessed by nature with this deep seaport, the fastest way to access the U.S. market, which is the largest economy in the world, is through LA Long Beach for this golden triangle. And time is money. So if you're going to New York by any other means from Asia, whether it's the Panama Canal or anywhere else, you're still 5 days faster if you're going through Southern California, if you're going for the Golden Triangle, LA, Long Beach. To Houston, it's 13 days faster. And why does that make a big difference? Imagine that you have $1 billion of inventory floating in the ocean, let's say your Walmart, for 13 extra days. First of all, that inventory is costing you money. But second, guess what happens, which is even worse? Your competitor, Target, is selling this $1 billion of goods that you don't have on the shelf. So you're losing both ways. So it's very important. Speed to market is critically important. And this is why our region is so important. This is, I won't spend too much time, but the world is basically gone into three clusters that really produce 95% of everything we consume. That's the North American cluster, anchored by America, Canada, and Mexico. Then we have the European with Germany in the center, and Asia with China. What does all this international trade mean and all this interconnectivity? So it really goes down to the core of how things have changed. So this is your basic laptop. It doesn't matter which brand it is. This is how many nations are involved in components, supplying components to a laptop. But if you go into the subcomponents, that tree just keeps on growing, right? So there's more and more and more and more countries involved in making literally any product at all. So this source map for a laptop. This is how many places things have to go to and from before you have a laptop that everybody thinks is made in China and then brought to America. That's not exactly what goes on. And in fact, it's not just that it's a few components or a few nations, but this is Apple, right? Apple makes a lot of products, iPhones, and Apple has 776 global suppliers that produce components that are then sent to China and assembled as an iPhone or any Apple component. So it isn't just high tech. This is the all-American pair of jeans. This is how many nations are involved in making our jeans. Our zippers are made mostly now in Japan. The dyes are made in Germany. They are the experts on those and so on and so forth, right? This is the all-American jeans. This is how many countries are involved in making our jeans. So when we say something is made in China, you know, it's not what we're really saying. It's not made in China. It's maybe put together and assembled in China, but not really manufactured in China. But it's not just high-tech stuff like iPhones and, this is the all-American pizza. Your olives are coming from Greece, your olive oil from Spain, and grain from all over the place. How many nations are involved in making the all-American pizza, right? So it's not just high-tech stuff. And all the way to big stuff like airplane. This is Boeing, all-American aircraft, right? This is how many nations are involved in making the major components. But if you broaden 700... Right, Boeing procures 783 million components from literally every nation in the world, and you can see those little dots. I don't know. That's how many countries are involved in making the all-American aircraft. So literally, it's impossible to make anything in one country anymore. There's not a single company anymore that masters all the resources and technology to make a single product. Right? So who are logistics companies? We all know Nike, for example, and Nike sells about $40 billion a year of athletic wear. How many shoes does Nike make? Right, zero, right? They're a big logistics company. They design them in Oregon. They procure raw material manufacturing all over the world. They get it to the customer. That's the broadest definition of logistics. They're a big logistics company. The largest company in the world today. corporation in the world, right? Apple, worth about $3 trillion, right? They sell billions of dollars of iPhones and devices and iPads. How many iPhones or iPads do you think Apple makes? Zero. Apple is a big logistics company, right? They design them in Cupertino, California. They procure all material manufacturing all over the world. They get 776 global suppliers to supply components to an iPhone, right? Get it to the customer. That's a logistics company. So the largest companies in the world today are actually logistics companies. In fact, if you flip, anybody has Apple product like iPhones? How many people have iPhones? Great, a lot of people. Well, if you flip it, have you ever seen if you flip it over, right? It doesn't say made by Apple, manufactured by Apple, assembled by Apple. You know what it says? It says designed by Apple, any product. And design sort of is a code word for logistics because they tried logistics and most people don't understand what it is. They think it's a disease. A few years back when I tell people we're doing logistics, they say, really? You went to the doctor and you got logistics. What do you have to take for it? Can I shake your hand? Is it contagious? UPS tried to make it a word that everybody would love. And remember the ad that says, we love logistics, we love logistics. A few months ago, didn't work. So they use design by basically saying we're a logistics company, right? So the largest companies in the world today are really fundamentally logistics company. So logistics has become the new manufacturing. This is how we make products. So the second thing that's changing is the shift from manual to technology skills. So what does that mean, right? So this used to be jobs. Somebody used to be a skilled, right, welder, and these were good paying jobs. Motors, it was a very highly paid job, sometimes management, because the product depending on good welds. If the car fell apart, problems, or if it squeaked, is that the right word? Squeaked and made noises because the welds weren't right, the chassis wasn't right, big problem. So they were highly skilled, highly professional. Well now, right, you're running the technology, the machine is doing the work. The welders today are, this is welders, GM assembly line. This is what the assembly line looks like today, right? This is where manufacturing jobs, right? We hear about bringing all these manufacturing jobs back into America, right? That's another thing that ain't exactly so. This is what the assembly line looks like today, right? We're shifting from manual skills to technology skills. And the interesting part, it's converging into a unified set of skills. So this is what you see in some logistics facilities, and this is what you see in the advanced manufacturing. And you notice that it's the same technology parallel skills, right? If you know around the machine, at GM, you know they're running machines.
So,
yes.
I'm sorry to interrupt you really quick. If anybody's parked across the street, yeah, I'm just told that's a private parking lot and you're going to need to get out of there. So if that is you, please move quietly out of the room. Okay. You're not parked across the street, are you?
No.
Okay, good. All right. Sorry.
It looks
sorry.
Like we lost half the audience now. Also, anybody had a lot of traffic getting here? There was a lot of traffic.
Okay, this would be a good opportunity for those of you that don't have a seat to grab a seat. That's logistics at its finest, I suppose. The supply chain is now opened up a little bit. Okay, so I apologize for the interruption. All right, so let's bring our voices down and keep going, Iddo.
Okay. So this whole shift from manual skill to technology skills isn't just in manufacturing. It's really happening across the board. So, you know, in the old days, if God forbid you had a major surgery, let's say a lung surgery, you need to have about 6-7 surgeons around you. They open you up, keep you going, and then close you up, and then you spend about a year recuperating. Well, now we have robotic surgery, right? This is the Da Vinci machine. We have hospital businesses also. We bought some of these machines in one of the hospitals. It's about $3 million machine, but it replaces about 6 surgeons, and the outcomes are much better. Now, if you have lung surgery, you have 3 small incisions, you know, the hospital a couple of days, third day for observation, next week you're going to work. All day they have to open you all up. So we're actually getting even better outcomes. But it isn't just in medicine, food. So McDonald's had a lot of problems in Japan with high labor costs. They sell fast reasonable prices. So this is really what's happening. The whole fast food industry is starting to get automated. Okay? And today robotics, anything a human hand can do, robotic arms can do today, right? Flipping hamburger is low tech. And they can actually do better than human, and the cost now is so inexpensive, it's trumping labor. So this is basically some of these machines that are in the lab, and you can see they're basically articulating what arms are doing. And this is sort of like the machine, but there's now machines that will make a full hamburger automatically, right? They're coming. And this is how, you know, we used to see fast food. This is what's gonna happen in Japan now, right? So the reality that these menial jobs have been going and being replaced by technologies that were on. So most of you are too young in here, but it used to be that the only thing to some record store, look for the record, drive back home, put in the machine, listen to music, right? Now, iTunes, right? Every town in America had record stores. Millions of people employed, right? Store clerk, store manager, assistant manager, cashier, stocking, record store, right? Now it's iTunes, there's no more record stores. Guess what? Those jobs didn't go to China. Tell you where they went. They went to iTunes. There's people now still selling you music, but instead of standing behind a counter and a cashier selling you a record, they're sitting behind technology. You don't see them, but Apple has almost 600,000 employees selling you music. Right? And iTunes and those devices. So again, we're shifting from manual skills to technology skills. Same thing with truck. Everybody heard about autonomous driving cars. This is an autonomous driving truck. Actually, the first one was licensed in the state of Nevada. The governor gave it its first plate and it went across the Hoover Dam. So that's coming as well. And what happens, driver skills will be upgraded from simply holding a steering wheel to actually doing some management functions while you're driving, because you have the time to do it now. So with all of this, what is really going on over here? Is everybody going to be replaced by some robotics and automation system? And is that gonna cost us all the jobs? So the reality, what does it mean for jobs? So this is not a new phenomenon, right? It already happened like 100 years ago when you're on the farm, before a tractor and electricity and so forth. If you wanted to plow 100 acres, you need to have 30 people behind a horse and plow, and it took you a week to plow 100 acres. Then came technology, the tractor. One guy on a tractor plows 100 acres in a day, right? Same thing, in 1800, actually 1900, it took 20 to harvest 10 acres of wheat, and then came the combine. This machine harvests 10 acres in 6.7 minutes, right? So what happens in the days where everybody was occupied with menial labor? If you went to the stores in those days, right, you'd have, you know, 12 different kinds of canned foods to choose from, you know, 4 different kinds of shoes, you know, 3 different iframes, a few dresses, right? Not too much to choose in those days. But what happened when you free of menial labor, right? And you're placing with productivity and productivity tools, you unleash a huge amount of creativity and productivity. So when you go to the supermarket today, there's not 12 different canned foods and 4 different things to choose from. There's 100,000 items. Each one of them has to be conceived, designed, engineered, manufactured, right, distributed, accounted for, banked, right, advertised. Way more people for menial jobs and get into more productivity. Same thing, you go to the mall today, there's not 12 different dresses hanging or 4 different shoes to choose from or, you know, 3 different frames of eyeglasses. You got thousands, right? So each one of those items, again, has to be conceived, designed, manufactured, right, distributed, accounted for, advertised, right, bank, so on and so, finance, huge amount. The reality is there's 2 things that cause more jobs when we get more technology involved in automation. One is simply we get more productive, we come up with new stuff. The second thing is human nature. We want more, right? If you wanted to live like in the 1900s, a nice house, nice furniture, but no car payments, right? There's no cars yet, no electrical payments, no cable payments, no, you know, no phone payments, right? No televisions. You could work for 17 weeks and live in that way. But people want to work more because they want more. They want the televisions, they want the cable, they want the iPhones, they want more. So more drives the demand for more, and people are willing to work more to get more. And this is what drives our economy. This is sort of a fundamental thing that's happening. But if some of you wanted to live comfortably like they did in 1900 before all this automation and equipment, and you know, you could work for 17 weeks, it'll suffice. So what's the truth about manufacturing? We hear about that we don't manufacture anything in America anymore, and everything has been offshored, and we're now waiting for all these jobs to come back, and we don't make anything in America anymore. Well, what's the truth? The truth is that we manufacture twice as much as we ever did, but we're doing it with about a quarter of the labor, right? And so where did all the manufacturing jobs go, right? What happened? That's millions of jobs. So to explain that, and explain what happened with the automation of computation, which is computers, right? So in 1972, right, the only people who can afford to automate computation was the federal government or big corporation. They have a $100 million computer. It's not very, you know, you can program it too easily. It's very costly to operate. So if you're the federal government, you have a $100 million computer. If you're a big corporation. If you were General Electric in those days, you couldn't afford a $100 million computer. You'd hire 500 engineers, give them slide rulers. Most of you have never seen it. Was this time before calculators, and you know, you pay them salary, pension, right, healthcare, and they were employees and they were doing computation. It took you a month. So as computers got more and more, right, programmable, faster and faster and cheaper, from 50 million to now 2,500, right, dollar for a laptop, and this laptop will do for $2,500 what it took 500 engineers a month to do in 1972, right? So even IBM, when they started with computers, they used to advertise, right? They say that this computer will replace about 150 engineers with slide rulers and free up what? Free up, right? They will no longer spend valuable time, right, computing, rather creating. And that's what happened. Instead of all these engineers, you know, doing computation, they start developing new products, which, you know, we saw what happened. And so how does that relate to manufacturing? So if you have a robotic arm automation, you know, General Motors, and when a robotic arm costs $25 million, it's very slow and not very programmable, you're going to hire 500 people on the factory floor, pay them salary, pension, healthcare, to take up a tie, have in school 5 bolts all day long. But when automation gets more and more advanced, it's more and more programmable, right? Faster and cheaper, from 25 million to 10, to 7, to 5, to 3, to 2.5, to 1, to 700,000, to about $200,000. So then he can pick up a tie and put on a hub and screw 5 bolts all day long. For 200,000, you're gonna replace, right, 500 people on the factory floor with one of these robotic arms. So what really happened in America over the last 25 years, we have lost jobs in manufacturing due to automation and technology at the rate of 2 to 3% a year. Hardly noticeable. But 2 to 3% over 25 years, that's 50 to 75% of our labor force was lost to automation and technology, not to China, right? China got about 10% of that. Most of it was lost due to technology and automation. And that's because that's what our factories look like in America. And you can see what happened. If you look at the top, this flat line on top, this is for about 30 years, our manufacturing jobs were pretty steady, all the way to 1999. And what happened in 1999? You see in the top graph, which is looks at employment in manufacturing, starts to dive. And the bottom graph is a graph that looks at when automation and robotics, right, the technology and the price just converge to the right point where it will start to get into our factory. So as automation and robotics get into the factory, you saw our labor force in manufacturing got down. And we see it in everything, right? The only way to watch a movie a few years ago is to go to a Blockbuster, right, or a video store early enough on Friday so nobody else gets the movie. You drive home, you watch Netflix. Every town in America had video stores. Millions of people employed. Those guys are not in China. We used to have bank tellers and so forth, right? So a lot of those jobs have been replaced by technology and automation. And you can see there the red is employment and the blue is essentially the introduction of more and more technology and automation into our business systems and manufacturing. So you can see what really happened here. They didn't really go to China. There's about $267 billion of automation and equipment that's going to go to our factories in the next 5 years. You're going to see even more accelerated pace of what's happening here. But it isn't just in manufacturing of hard goods. This is a new technology now that actually writes news articles. Right, so a lot of the news you see on the web, you think it's somebody, some journalist wrote it, it's automatically generated from facts. And you can see the graphs there without stumbling too much. It now almost fools people. You can't tell whether a computer wrote it or a person wrote it. But they're not going to use that because they found out that computers can't generate fake news. So they're going to be using journalists. So it's not going to sell very well, but still, it's happening in a lot of different fields. So what's the truth about outsourcing? Why do you hear about companies going overseas? You know, we hear it all the time, we're trying to bring it back. The reality is, it's speed to market, right? It's all about speed to market, not labor cost. So if we wanted to make this iPhone, if we all in the room came up with this iPhone, and we said we want to be so patriotic that we want to build it in America, and we were more patriotic than we want to build it right here in Riverside County, right? And we need a big plant, like the Sketcher building, 2 million square feet, like we build. So we go to the city, and now we have to start with what they call NOP, Notice of Preparation for an EIR. We have to do the environmental review, so we spend 6 months negotiating on that. And now we start with our EIR, and we spend a year and a half to 2 years doing that. Now it's 2.5 years later, and we're ready to go to the Planning Commission and City Council. And depending who screams the loudest in front of them on that day, maybe we get approved, maybe we don't. But we're good people, we get approved. So now it's 2.5 years later, we got approved. But this is California, we have CEQA. Any people familiar with CEQA? Not too many, but CEQA is a big, burdensome process. And the only way to enforce CEQA, this process in the state, is through the courts. There's no state agency that you finally do your plan, and they stamp it, and you see they did good, right? And go on. You get sued. Every project of any consequence in California gets sued. So now we spend another 2-3 years in litigation, so now we're 5.5 years later, we typically win, and we finally pull the permits, and we start building it. Takes us a year and a half. So seven and a half years later, we finally have our factory ready to produce the iPhones we all came up with. You know what happens in 7 years? Samsung would have sold a billion units, would have no business. So the reason people go overseas is, okay, not cheap labor costs. For example, if Apple moved the iPhone manufacturing into the United States, it will only be a $2 to $3 price difference on the retail level. So not there because of cheap labor. In fact, there's another misnomer. The only amount of money that Apple spends in China is about $7 assembling the iPhone. But this is another thing that is not exactly what people think, and that is how we account for trade deficit. So the way we account trade deficits or our trade accounting in America is we take the value of the product as it departs a country into the United States, and assign that value to that country. So, for example, Apple only spends $7 in China, but it comes into America as a $600-$700 iPhone, and we say we have a trade deficit of $600 with China. No, we only have $7 there. In fact, this little graph, it might be hard to see. If you do the trade deficit accounting, for Apple, you will say that they have a $2 billion trade deficit with China. But if you subtract that out, the $600 accounting, we actually have, you see this green line, we actually have a trade surplus with China, not a trade deficit. This is how it looked like when I first realized what was going on. You know, you hear about all these deficits, but, and that's because there's not a lot of people there for a dollar a day making iPhone. This is what the factory is that make iPhone look like. Highly manufacturing facilities. These are not a bunch of people for a dollar a day making iPhones. But there is some manufacturing that went to China and offshore. If you had a low added value good with a large labor component, China making teddy bears and things like this. But that's not exactly the manufacturing we're looking forward to bring back to America to have jobs for our kids, is making teddy bears. So, but people keep on telling me, say, Iddo, but how can you say that? Every time I go to Walmart, everything I touch is made in China. You know, my clothes made in China, your shoes made in China, your watch made in China, everything is made in China. Well, it finally dawned on me. We import about $480 billion of consumer goods into America from China. So everything we touch and feel looks like it's made in China. But guess what? This $480 billion is only 2.4 of our $18 trillion, almost $19 trillion US economy. So if we can bring everything back from China, it's a rounding error. So when we're all waiting for all these jobs to come back to America, it's nice to say politically, but they're not there. People used to be in the record stores are not in China. The people used to be your bank tellers are not in China. People used to be in the video stores are not in China, and so on and so forth. Fourth is the change from subtractive to additive manufacturing. And what is that? How many people know what subtractive or additive manufacturing? Let me explain what it is. Additive manufacturing is the third industrial revolution. And what we do in the economy today is subtractive manufacturing. Subtractive basically means, let's say we want to make a baseball bat, we take material and we subtract from it, right? We take a piece of wood and we mill it, you know, lathe machine, and we make a baseball bat. So we're subtractive material to make a product, and then we make pieces and then we put them together and we make a product. That's subtractive manufacturing. That's how most of the world does it today. Well, now we're doing additive manufacturing, which is like 3D printing. Everybody seen a 3D printer? You're basically printing products, right? You're not subtracting material, you're adding material, right? For those of you who don't understand, I'll always simplify it. If you ever had those, you know, small HP printing machines that add ink, and you do a square and you put it through and you basically put a little tiny dots of ink, right, in a pattern that you told it on your computer. Imagine you take the same piece of paper and you run it through the printer over and over again, 1,000 times. So it's printing that square on top of each other, right? And these little droplets of ink are starting to build up to the point where you're making a box. That's an oversimplified version of what additive is. But so this is subtractive and this is additive, right? You're actually printing the part. And why is this important? Because it's changing the opportunities in our region as well. So aerospace is very advanced in it. You can see how they're making components, they're printing them. And essentially, I don't know if my time is up or that's it. Where should I point? Oh, there you go. So you see those on the left, right, to make a turbine. To make a turbine, you'd have to, in the old days, or the days still today, you take pieces of metal, you fabricate them, you mill them, then you weld them together, you polish them. Well, now, you see on the top, it's printing those pieces, not, right, not fabricating them. So Toshiba, a lot of companies are going to full additive manufacturing, right? This is the big commercial size machines. Instead of in what we see today in our big logistics facility, we bring components together, put them together and send it to the customer, now those things won't even exist until you order them and then they'll be printed right there. And this is what it looks like. Our logistics is going to transform into additive manufacturing, advanced manufacturing centers. And in the next 5 years, these machines are going to cost 50% less and are going to be about 400% faster. So you can see where this is going. More and more products are going to be made that way. And you can see this is the additive manufacturing market. It's going to start going through the roof. And you'll see more and more of these things become commonplace. In fact, it's becoming mainstream. Additive goes mainstream. Nike has announced they're going to start making a lot of the shoes with additive manufacturing. Instead of putting them together the old ways, they're actually going to print the shoe. And that's already happening. And it's not just in product. This is an additive manufacturing of how we do construction. Like this machine actually lays out the concrete and builds it out like you will do 3D printing in large scale. And this is the kind of basic home it makes. It's basic now, but you can see what will happen in 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years. You put a machine up and it's gonna basically build up the house. By the way, because there's no labor and no wasted material, you don't have to transport bricks and, you know, lumber and so forth, these houses will be about 40 to 50% cheaper to manufacture. Right? Because usually labor is about 50%. So you see what's happening. The jobs are transferring. Instead of having a carpenter that knew how to put two pieces of wood together, you'd have somebody who knows how to run the technology to basically build. But the last thing that's really shifting in our economy is the shift from analog to digital commerce. And we all know what it is. That's e-commerce, right? How many people have not bought anything on the internet? Nobody. All right, everybody's doing it now. And this is how we used to go shopping, right? And the infrastructure to support this looked like this, right? Now we do shopping like this, and the infrastructure to support this shopping looks like this, right? And this whole thing is becoming huge globally. It's already $2.3 trillion in e-commerce globally. And in America, it has huge ramifications. So in America, we're a consumer society. We buy $4 trillion worth of goods. And we buy them through 12 billion square feet of brick and mortar retail center. All the shopping centers in America, 12 billion square feet of them, and we buy about $4 trillion worth of goods for them. But this year, e-commerce was already 10% of retail, $400 billion. And think what happened. People didn't notice it. If you had to sell $400 billion worth of products, through brick and mortar retail, we have to have built another 1.2 million square feet, billion square feet of brick and mortar retail stores, which never got built in America, but the product was sold through logistics center, like Amazon. People don't realize what's been happening. 1.2 billion square feet of shopping centers in America were not built because it moved. But it's more fundamental. Our model for retail in America is the anchor tenant, right? We all know the mall. We have anchor tenants, right? Sears and JCPenney, and everybody does business in between. If your anchors goes away, it's big trouble, right, for the mall. And if you look what happened, retail sales at department stores, which are the anchors, peaked around the year 2000. By 2015, they were back to where they were in 1990, like 15 years ago. So essentially, what happens in 2015, the average sales per square foot was $165, which was already a quarter less than was 10 years earlier, right? So if you take somebody like JCPenney, which anchors a lot of centers in America, they would have to close 320 stores just to get back to 2006 sales, almost 10 years ago, 11 years ago, right? Sears will have to close, you know, 300 stores. And you, by the way, you heard last week the announcement Sears, JCPenney are losing about that many stores. By the way, I had this presentation done about a year ago, and it just took a year, and they announced just about that amount of closings. Now, the problem is when the anchor goes, the mall fails. When the mall fails, right, the whole shopping center goes. And already, it's not so visible in California, but 270 regional malls in America closed down because the anchors left, right? So it has huge ramification. It's not just the big anchors. You can see, I don't know if you can see there, but, you know, a lot of companies from Gap to everybody else, even Walmart closed about 200 stores, right? A lot of things are moving to e-commerce. And you can see what's happening. All the big traditional retailers, the stock value is going down because what Wall Street does, the price of stock really projects the earning, the future earning ability of those companies, and they all see that they are not going to do so well, and those who are in e-commerce are going up, right? And Steve Jobs understood it early, right? He said basically logistics at the forefront of retail, and the distinction between warehouse and retail is blurring, and shops is blurred. And so essentially logistics is becoming also the new retail. And it's changing because we used to go to the shopping center, now we expect the goods to come to us, right? Right? Delivery. And what also is going to accelerate it is what we call the Internet of Things, right? Everybody heard of the term Internet of Things? What happens is the computer chip has got so inexpensive that in 1980, 1 gigabyte, right, cost about $1 million. You know what it is today? Okay. 1 cent. In fact, you can't even buy one. It's so cheap that you got to buy a lot of them. And because it's so cheap, it starts to get embedded in a lot of devices. So, for example, there'll be about 25 billion, you know, products connected. And what does that mean? Samsung just announced the new refrigerator. It's actually taking inventory of what's inside your refrigerator because the product has an embedded chip. So you can do, you know, it knows how much milk. You can program yourself and say, you know, when my milk is down to a quart, my ketchup is down to 2 ounces, populate my shopping list, and then it shows up on your phone, right? And they made a deal with MasterCard, and you'll be able to push, you know, purchase, and you select the time you want it delivered, and the stuff come to you. And people think, right? And people think supermarkets will always be there. But the reality is, what is the one or the products that you buy over and over again you don't need to see anymore, you just want to get them, right? What is a supermarket? It's a primitive distribution center. They put it closer to the customer. They stock it with all the products, 20 ketchups, 2 eggs, everything else. They make the customer go to the warehouse, do his own picking in the basket, go check it out, and deliver it to, right? Deliver it to yourself, take it home. Well, you don't need to go see the same ketchup. People buy the same ketchup over and over again, the same diapers over and over again. You don't need to see the product. You just need to get it delivered. So there'll be also a big transformation of what's going to happen in the grocery business. In Korea, it's already happening. Well, this is virtual supermarkets. These products are not real. People are just using their iPhone and selecting the product they need. I came back from Israel. This actually blew my mind. They put this thing on me, and they say, right, a virtual supermarket. Any supermarket you want, the nicest place you've ever been, And then you can populate the list. Let's say you want so much, you know, you're worried about your cholesterol, about the amount of sodium, amount of fats, whatever it is. You put your criteria, and the only things that populate the shelves are items that fit your criteria. You can never buy wrong, right? They're all going to be healthy for you. And this is starting now, but you see what will happen in 2, 3, 4, 5 years with all of this. Now, people say clothes, right? Big problem in retail and e-commerce. You buy the clothes, then you return it because it doesn't fit you. Well, now there's new scanning machines. They're so accurate that they give a very, very precise, you know, artificial mannequin of you. And now you can have exactly the, you can see the clothes exactly as it might look on you. So it's going to reduce this whole issue about what does that look. In fact, Toshiba is getting big into this. They already put some centers in Europe where you can see that you can actually not even change the clothes and see exactly how they might look on you. And so how is, you know, people ask me all the time, well, how quickly is all of this going to happen? Well, pretty quick. I can tell you, like the other predictors, economists can tell you exactly when things are coming back. I can tell you that, but give an example. Hilton spent 93 years to amass 610,000 hotel rooms, right, in about 80, 90 countries around the world. Airbnb, in 4 years, amassed 650,000 beds in about 192 countries around the world. So how fast are things happening, right? Faster than we think. And so there's implication. This is fundamental to all of us. Is the jobs that are coming up, 80% of the jobs over the next decades are going to be technical skills. There's no more manual skills. 80% of the jobs are technical skills. And so it's a problem because if you rank the 15 top industrial nations in the world in terms of STEM and technical skills, we, the United States, are 14th. You know who number one is? China. You think they have all this cheap labor and people working, right, in these factories. They're the number one in producing people because they understand. They're also the number one purchasers, consumer of automation and robotic. If not many people, they wouldn't be the one doing it, but they're the number one market. And we're actually 50% below the world average. So this is serious. We need to get it right. In fact, the most underestimated business risk for our region, here about a lot of risk, but the most underestimated business risk for our region is the lack of skilled workforce, you know, to support advanced logistics and additive manufacturing. Because if we don't have the skills in the region, it doesn't matter what interest rates are, it doesn't matter what anything else is. If you have 80% of the population not able to get the jobs of the future, there is no future. So this is very, very important for everybody to understand and to make any effort you can, whether it's in your local communities, your school districts, the business community, any community, because I see that ship going into this iceberg, which people wake up one day and say, gee, these companies are coming or they're not coming. Because there's no one who can do the job. And I had to explain it to a fifth graders the other day in school. I was asked to speak there. And I said, look, imagine that you're a contractor and you have to put a ditch to put a pipe, right? And you have a bunch of people with shovels, because that's all they know how to do. But you have one of these big trenchers, you know, like a ditch witch. They can make that trench, right? You know, that piece of equipment that digs up. But nobody knows how to operate it. So you have this equipment, right? You have the dozer. Right? Or you have the backhoe, but no one knows how to operate it. So you're a contractor, you want to come in our region and build something, and there's no one who knows how to operate a backhoe, you got to do everything by hand. Right? That's not very good. So, in summary, I was asked to say a few words about one of the projects. It really responds to this additive manufacturing, logistics, the merging of all of them, which is one of our projects called the World Logistics Center. It's a paradigm shift, and I want to explain it to you in 2 minutes. As you saw, to make anything today, right, you have to bring components together to make any product. And so this is, for example, a laptop. This is how many suppliers come into Dale. And this is what happens in the LA Basin if you connect all the different suppliers that have to bring together a product. And this is what it looks like if you, you know, from an area on the LA Basin. You have the big dots of the big nodes and all suppliers that supply them. So people are going all over, creating a lot of traffic, pollution, movements, and costs all over the LA Basin. And so this is, on the left is what it looks like, and on the right is what the World Logistics Center will do, and I'll explain this in a minute. So what we have today is this arbitrary placement of location. Right? You have Best Buy over here, and you have Samsung bringing television from over there, and Sony's over there, and Apple is over there. They all have to get together these facilities to do their business. What we're doing in a logistics cluster, you see, we take a lot of the big anchors, right? Imagine it's like Best Buy, to make a simple example. And then you start bringing all the suppliers, right? All the suppliers around them. So what happens is we go from random configuration in the LA Basin to a cluster, right? And the cluster is much more efficient. So you see, if you look at A, this is how many, if you plot movements to number of nodes, right, connection, because this is what we do with supply, you have, right, in a random configuration is A, in a cluster configuration is B, and right, and this is the big efficiency factor. So some of you maybe know the SketchUp building, and the SketchUp building took five facilities, we consolidated into a cluster, into one building, and SketchUp today is saving $25 million of annual operating costs. So people say, why SketchUp where they are? It's not because of anything except $25 million of annual operating savings. So we'll create out there about 20,000 jobs in our region. We'll spend about $2.5 billion. It'll produce about $2.5 billion in our regional economy, which also drives housing. We're doing it very sustainable. The new technology diesel that we're using is actually so clean that UC Riverside put this out. They said an 18-wheeler driving from Baltimore to Chicago, or from Chicago to Baltimore, right, produces less pollution than barbecuing four hamburgers. So be careful in 4th of July, your neighbors, you're killing your neighbors if you're doing hamburger. You might as well drive a big rig around the block. It'll be safer. And we're saving a lot of water, about 2,000 acre feet of water with our new technologies. There'll be a lot of solar. We have LEED Gold certified buildings, but this is the end, and I want to ask you something. To be, right, on the global map, we're talking about a global economy, and how do you differentiate yourself? How do you make people know where you are, right? I go all over the world, and I say, we're in the Inland Empire. They say, where? Where are you? They don't know where the Inland Empire is. So a simple shape can put you on the global map. I want to ask you, anybody recognize what city this is? Okay, what about now? All right, a simple shape put you on the global map. You know where this is? Okay, can you tell now? Yeah, a simple shape, right? You know where this is? What about now? Sydney, right? A simple shape puts you on the global map. So if you saw this water, you won't know where it is in the world, right? But now, you know, it's Australia, right? So a simple shape can put you in the global map. So in summary, I'm going to show you a little video which will close my presentation. It's sort of what the World Logistics Center looks like driving on the 60 freeway heading east in Moreno Valley. So, and you will see something that may put us on the global map. So this is this bridge is, those of you familiar with the area, it's Redlands Boulevard, and we're headed east towards Palm Springs. And you will notice there is a bridge. It will be the new bridge over Theodore. So we're working with the city and Caltrans to put this bridge in sort of a shape of a triangle, because we're sort of at the gateway into the Southern California Golden Triangle. But you can drive anywhere in Southern California and not know where you are. But maybe if you see this bridge and you cross this bridge, it might put us on the global map. So thank you. I appreciate it.
First of all, let me just ask a simple question. How many of you think 2017 will be better than 2016? Raise your hands. Thank you very much. That's the forecast. Okay, what I want to do is take a look at the Inland Empire economy, where it went last year, where we think it's going to go this year, and comment as I go along on some of the things I think you may be seeing as a consequence of the Trump presidency. So I'll work all that hopefully together. The starting point always for talking about our area is the national economy. All those negative bars you see up there, that is the Great Recession. We lost 8.71 million jobs during that period of time. Catastrophic downturn. Many of you were affected by it. Then you see three really tall bars. Don't get excited. That was hiring census workers. Then you see four negative bars. That was laying them off. After that, you see a long period of continuous growth that is relatively slow. It does have one advantage. If you grow slowly, you generally don't do something incredibly stupid. Incredibly stupid was what happened with the mortgage meltdown. Incredibly stupid back in the early part of the last decade was when the dot-com stocks all went nuts and then crashed. Right now, we don't have that in the economic mix. Now, if we put all those positive bars together, here's what we get. We've added altogether 15.57 million jobs. So we lost 871. We've gained back not quite double that. So as we sit here, as of the beginning of this year, the economy was 6.8 million jobs higher than it had ever been, going back to before the recession, which is 5% more jobs than the economy has seen. So that is a first important fact. Second fact deals with unemployment rates. There are two ways of measuring unemployment. The standard way is to go to households, knock on the door, and ask essentially three questions. Question number one, do you have a job? If the answer to that is yes, you're employed and you're in the labor force. If the answer is no, then there's a second question. What did you do this month to try and find a job? If the answer is, I got tired of trying to find a job and I quit, you are no longer unemployed. You've just dropped out of the market. So that's a conservative way of looking at unemployment, and it is those bottom numbers. They peaked at 8%. They've dropped as low as 4.4, and that's where it was the last time we measured it. These are not seasonally adjusted data. They jump up and down depending on the month, but you can see how far down it's gone. Now there's a second measure. The second measure includes everybody in the first measure, but it adds two groups in. Group number one, people are working part-time who would rather be working full-time. So they're regarded as underemployed. They're added back in. So they're the second as unemployed. The second thing that we add into it are people who dropped out along the lines of what I said. They just got sick of looking because they hadn't found a job. This is called the U6 measure, and when we look at it, it peaked at 18%, and it's down to about 9.1. Now, question is, where are we in terms of unemployment in the country? The best way to look at this is to compare it to the absolute best time. If we do that in each case, the 4.4 is almost exactly at the absolute lowest it's been, and that was during the period of 05, 06, 07, when things are really spinning fast. The U6 measure was down to 8, so 9.1, there's still a little bit of slack. But the fact of the matter, no matter how we look at it, there is not a lot of extra workers running around loose, using either measure, which is very important to you, because when the unemployment rates get down to these levels, that is when prices start to move, and that is when the Fed starts to grind down on the economy by raising rates. And they'll probably raise rates again this month. That certainly is the indicator. Now, so that's the national. The problem you see with that, if we look at the Trump administration, what has he talked about? Lowering taxes and a massive increase in infrastructure spending and also now defense spending. There's only one way to get to that. If you can't grow your way out of it, and you don't really seem to have the labor force slack to do it, the only way you do that is with deficit spending. Essentially, you don't take as much out of the economy in taxes as you push in spending, which tries to run it faster. It's like taking a balloon that seems to be full and then trying to blow a lot more air into it. When that happens, you get an increased pressure on prices, and that's when the Fed starts to act. So that's one of the things I think you will be seeing happen during the course of this year. Now, switching down to California, how's this state? Remember, the U.S. is 5% over where it ever been. This is a picture of, again, job growth and job destruction in California. During the course of the recession, we lost 1.76 million jobs, or 1.78 million jobs. If we look at what we added back over 2 million jobs. Altogether, we've gone from 15.8 to 16.9. California is up 6.7% in jobs. So we've outgrown what the country did going up 5% during the course of the recovery and the expansion. Then there is the Inland Empire. First of all, if you are ever outside of the Inland Empire and you are talking to somebody about this place, please tell them one thing. The Inland Empire is not some small suburb of Los Angeles. We have a population of 4.5 million. Where does that put us as a state? Half the U.S. states have less people than Riverside and San Bernardino counties combined. We just passed Kentucky to put us at that spot. So half the states are bigger, half the states are smaller. We're right in the center. We're the median state, in effect. Now, what does that mean? Well, just to put it in another example, who's two states lower than us? Oregon. Oregon has 450,000 people less than these two counties. We are not some minor place as people up in the Bay Area or in Sacramento seem to think. This is a state. In fact, I'd like to get rid of this as a state so, or make a state out of it so I can run for Senate. Now, what's going on in our state of the Inland Empire? Well, here you see the same kind of a picture. A lot of blue bars where we added growth. However, we lost 10.8% of our jobs during the course of the Great Recession. So it was a big 10.8% drop, 140,000 jobs. Now, it looks like we added 47,000 jobs this year, or this last year, which is a brand new number. All during the year, the Employment Development Department gives us numbers. And what did those numbers say when we had all 12 months? That we are up 38,000. Well, they revised them yesterday. So you're getting brand new data that I'd never seen before. That's why I keep looking at the monitor. We didn't go up 38,000. We went up 47,500. We added another 9,000 jobs, more than we thought we had. When we add that in, we've now gained back not quite 250,000 jobs since the recession, which puts us at 109,000 higher than we'd ever been before. We are up 8.3. So the Inland Empire, 8.3. State of California, 6.7. United States, 5.0. How are we doing, folks? We're doing great. Now, what do I think we'll do this year? Somewhere around 43,000. So we are very, very strong in this particular region, frankly, compared to the Now, one of the issues that always crops up is job quality. And there's no question that there is a piece of our growth that is not strong. If we look at this chart, the red section of it are the high-end jobs, jobs that pay over $55,000 a year. You'll notice in the state of California, it's 26.1%, so one out of every four round figures, state job is high-end for the whole state of California. If we look in our area, it's down at 12.4, so less than half that, with almost all of those jobs in one sector, healthcare. Now, healthcare is about to be under pressure given the release yesterday of the effect on the Affordable Care Act. If that goes through, this sector will be in trouble in this particular region because of the nature of our population and the help that that particular measure has done for us. But right now, 12.4 and 26.1. Then we have a group of sectors that are white collar, but they are moderate paying, 45 to 55,000. They are up here in green, 6.7 for the state, 7.1 for us, about the same share. Then there is the enormous difference, the other enormous difference. Where we're really strong is in three sectors put together, blue collar sectors, logistics, manufacturing, construction. In the Inland Empire, we're up at 39%. In California, 20.8. So we're much more of that than the state of California. Now, why is the state so weak in those sectors? Answer, all of the environmental regulation that has been put on manufacturing through CEQA, on construction, what they've been trying to do with logistics, all of that has in effect tried to squeeze down for the state of California those blue-collar sectors, which is what marginally educated people need if they're going to get to the middle class. So you have the irony, and I could say this because I used to be a Democratic campaign manager and put people in the state legislature professionally. The current leadership of the Democratic Party doesn't give a damn about getting people to the middle class. All they want is green, period, and they hardly think about any other subject. I used to be a registered Democrat. Now I'm a registered independent. I hate everybody. And I have absolutely no political opinions. Now you get to the bottom line, which is a crazy answer that you would never expect. When you look in these red bars, or red circles, you see the share of low-paying jobs. In the state, 46.9. In the Inland Empire, 41.6. We're much better off on the share of low-paying jobs compared to the state. The state has basically maneuvered itself into a place where it's creating two kinds of work, very high paying and very low paying. We have a greater balance here. Yes, we have an issue. We like more office-based, high-end jobs. We don't have that. That is our issue outside of medical care. But when you look at the overall picture, because we have a strong center to our economy, we're in better shape than the state. Go tell that to everybody in the Bay Area and Sacramento who thinks this is nothing but a low-end economy. With all due respect, they ought to get out of town and come down here and see what's going on. Now, here's job growth last year. Brand new numbers. I haven't seen these before. Los Angeles was the biggest metro area adding jobs, 109,000. Second was the Inland Empire, 47.5. Third, behind us, was San Francisco, San Mateo, which was behind us at 43.8. Then is Orange County at 35.7. And then you get to the Santa Clara metro area, which is Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley at 35.7, tied with Orange County, but altogether, what, 12,000 fewer jobs created in Silicon Valley than here. With all due respect, the world is not tilted to the north. I hope they all drowned. Now, when we, by the way, I was born in Northern California. Unemployment rates, when you look at the unemployment rate in the country, January, the national number was 5.1. In January, in the Inland Empire, was 5.6. So you notice that the gap between the two is very, very tiny. Look what it was back during the recession. We were way above the national. So we've, all that job growth has brought us down close to the national unemployment rate, which is good news in this particular region. Here is our major issue. Our major issue, frankly, is poverty. And this is why the blue-collar job growth and a lot of what Iddo Benzeevi was talking about is so important. What you look at is in San Bernardino County, 27.4% of children are living in poverty. Poverty, just to put it in numbers, is a family of four living on $2,000 a month or less. I've had some meals that cost that much. Now, when we look at all people, it's 19.7 in San Bernardino, it's 16.2 in Riverside. These are huge issues for us. That child issue is extremely important because if you think of the children, if they're in poverty, they've got to fight through poverty before they ever get to a classroom, and that's a quarter of our future labor force. So these are devastatingly important numbers. Now, to understand an economy, I always use the same example. I've been using it for 30 years. I apologize to those of you who've seen this before. But think of a gold mine town in the Old West. Now, how did that economy evolve? Step one, somebody finds gold. Now, what can you do with it? Nothing. So what do? You ship it away. So out it goes, and in comes money to the miners. Now, what do the miners need? They've now got money. You have the basis for an economy. Well, they need food, they need clothing, they need tools. So you end up with the general store. No mine, no general store. It is not retailing that drives the economy. It is the sector bringing in the money. What else do they need? Well, they need entertainment. So we have the saloon. Again, the people at the saloon only have jobs because the mine exists. They don't create it, it does. Now, there's a few guys in the audience here, you know, probably thinking what else the miners need. We'll skip that part. Now, what drives the Inland Empire economy? What are those key sectors? Number one is logistics and distribution, all the big facilities along the line of what Iddo was describing. Number two, construction, infrastructure construction, housing construction, offices, large facilities. Number three, healthcare, huge important. Number four, manufacturing. Number five, the high-tech office world. Those are the sectors that bring money to us, and then they create the modern secondary tier on the right, retailing, on the left, consumer services. Don't drive it. So when a city council is like, oh, we got a new ice cream parlor to come to town, that is not increasing economic activity. Economic activity is one dip down in that left-hand corner. Now let's look at them one at a time. First, and then I'll look at the real estate side effects of this as we go along. Healthcare. What about healthcare? What has it accomplished? Okay, the ACA, the Inland Empire Health Plan is a major nonprofit that happens to handle a large, large number of people in this region. It brought into them $1.23 billion last year. Of that, $1.08 billion went into the Inland Empire economy. About $450 million to doctors, about $440 million to hospitals and other facilities, and about $182 million into pharmacy. So this money hit the economy. And then from there, because it's coming from the outside world, it hits those people. And then as they spend, it ends up at Stater Brothers and in hair salons and all sorts of places like that. Very powerful effect on this economy. What has it accomplished in terms of public health? Well, if you go back to 2010, we had 744,000 people in our region with no health insurance. Today, it's down at 365 million, so it has gone down by 51% fewer people without health care. So that's what's at risk in this whole discussion. Now, you all deal with an economy. Think of supply and demand for health care. This has increased demand for health care dramatically, which increases healthcare employment. And if, in fact, you withdraw part of that, it will lower the growth of a sector where a huge number of people are working in technical jobs. I've been through two major surgeries. I love interviewing people, and so I interview everybody that comes close to me when I'm in the hospital. So the last person I talked to was a nurse anesthesiologist when she stuck the mask on my face and knocked me out to shut me up. But the fact is, most people who work in the medical field are not doctors. They're technicians, MRI, sonographers, all of that sort of stuff. Now, this is our fourth fastest growing sector. The yellow on this chart are high paying sectors, 55,000 and above. Healthcare, clearly one, added 11.1% of all the jobs from 2011 through 2016. That's the period of turnaround and expansion. So that's what's happened there. The sector pays not quite 60,000 as a median, half above, half below. Very good paying sector. And in fact, it has been our best sector for continuous job growth. It never went down. Even in the recession, this sector expanded. Obviously, it is a sector that's potentially under threat depending on what happens with the Affordable Care Act. Now, second, sophisticated warehousing operations. This is something Iddo was talking about. What you're looking at here is one guy and a whole bunch of machines. The fact of the matter is, this is a sector that is getting increasingly sophisticated. The folks who work in it are having to have their skills upgraded in order to work with the kind of machinery and software that they have. It used to be that this was a sector where I worked in it. I went to college. I worked for GM. I pushed a cart. I had a list, and I picked parts. Well, what have you replaced? Me, the cart, and the list. Other than that, it's the same thing. What's gone on is you've completely revolutionized this sector, and it's changing very rapidly because of the whole use of technology. But stop and think. If I've got all those machines, somebody has to be able to calibrate them, to tune them, to do the programming, to keep the programming accurate. Somebody has to be able to fix stuff. So the same kind of techniques that were used in manufacturing, where you need somebody that can maybe do welding or somebody that can work with metal, you need all those skills in this field as well. Now, here you have to understand a little of my lifestyle. Because one of the things that drives this sector for us is the value of the dollar. Here you see it 100. Now, we measure it on a measure of 100, so 0 to 100. This is where it was back in 2012, 2013, relatively low. This is where it is now, almost back to 100. How much has it gone up? 25.6%. So what? This is a bottle of Montrachet. Montrachet is a French Burgundy wine. That bottle of wine 4 years ago, I saw in a restaurant for $4,000. By the way, I've seen the same bottle for $16,000 in a different restaurant now. It is the most valuable wine that you can get that's white. I love it. Now, so I said to my wife 4 years ago, Deborah, can I have a bottle of Montrachet? The answer, do you want me to be your fourth ex-wife? Says a little about my lifestyle. She said no, but look at this. $4,000 now is $29.75. Not because the French changed the price of the wine, but because the dollar is worth more when you exchange it for euros. The result of that is anything, not just Montrachet, anything we buy from the rest of the world is now less expensive by about 25% to the people buying it because of the fact that our dollar has gone up in value, which means imports are encouraged by that fact. At the same time, exports are discouraged. Why? Because everything we sell costs about that amount more to our customers around the world. This is something that both Trump and the Speaker of the House are very nervous about. High imports, low exports, which, by the way, has been the history of the United States. For years, we've had more going out than coming in terms of dollars. So, here's what we see. These green bars are the volumes going through the ports of LA Long Beach of loaded containers. The inbound containers, imports, are at 8.0 million 20-foot equivalent containers. What does that mean? That is the measure we use. The peak was 8.2. That was when the China trade had taken off. It fell off to 8.0, which we're now tied with in 07. Dropped all the way down to 6, but it's worked its way back up again to almost a record level. The beginning of this year, it looks like it's coming in at a record. On the bottom in the yellow bars, you see exports. Not surprisingly, given the value of the dollar, falling off. We don't handle exports to a large extent in the Inland Empire. Our job growth is driven by imports because we handle all that trade coming in. So we've had huge amounts of net industrial space absorption. 17.5 million square feet for the four quarters entered in December. That's, by the way, there is no other place. What's second in the United States? Honestly, who cares? They're so far behind us, it doesn't even count. Now, our vacancy rate, which when we had a lot of stuff in the recession, soared up to about 12.8, is now down to a little under 4. 4% vacancy rate is essentially none. As a result, we see a lot of construction. Well, place a tariff on imports. Imports become more expensive. What is a tariff? It's a tax on you. It just says we're going to call these goods cost more. So when you go to Costco or you go to Walmart or you go to Home Depot, the goods will cost more because we put a tax on you called a tariff. Now, this whole thing is sold as a tax on the other country. No, it's tax on the American consumer to get you to quit buying so much imports by making them more expensive. That would reduce U.S. jobs handling imports. It would affect this particular market. It would improve manufacturing to the extent that automation allows that to happen. Remember, automation is taking a lot more jobs than anything else that's going on in terms of the job markets. But it also means higher prices at retail stores. Now, then there is the border tax that the House is looking at. What does it do? Stop and think for a minute. You're a retailer, and you buy $80 of American products, and you sell them for $100. What do we tax you on? $20. The difference. Your revenue minus your cost. Now, let's say you're a U.S. manufacturer, and you make a good, and you sell it for $80 to France. What are you taxed on? Zero. We wouldn't tax you on anything you sell overseas. But then there is the kicker. If you're a retailer, think every retailer practically that you shop at, and you buy goods overseas for $80, and you sell them here for $100, you won't be allowed to deduct the $80. You'll be taxed on the $100. Well, what's that going to do to retail prices? They will go up dramatically to you. Why? To get you to quit buying all that stuff at those places. There is going to be a bloodbath in Congress over this. Because if you're from the Midwest, you love it. If, however, you happen to be in Southern California or from poorer communities that use those kinds of retail goods, you're not going to particularly care for this. So it'll do these things, but most importantly, it will discourage imports, encourage exports, could get a lot of money that's been parked overseas to come home. Now, who in this audience did not buy something online for Christmas last December? Raise your hand. I see about four of you. Four of you lose your American citizenship. Now, what are we saying here? This was 1.1% of retail sales in this country. It's now down or up to 8.4. It is growing at 15% per annum compounded. How would you like your 401k to be growing at 15% on automatic? That's how fast it's going up. And this, again, goes along with what Iddo was saying. This is the future. Forget the mall. It's going to be coming out of large box types of operations. So all new facilities in industrial being constructed in Southern California are in the Inland Empire. Who's second? Again, who cares? It's LA. It's way down at what, 7? Have some. Now, one of the things that's happened here is the profitability of people investing in these types of facilities have gone up. It's now 17.5% higher than it was before the recession started. So it's gone up. It's gone up 70% since the bottom of the recession. And these are the asking rates for large facilities in the Inland Empire. How many jobs created? Over 1 out of 5 of our jobs was created in this sector. That doesn't, if money comes to somebody working for, say, Amazon, and they take their check home, and then they go to Stater Brothers, they create jobs at Stater Brothers. They go get their hair done, they create jobs at the hair salon. So it's more than that in terms of impact. Hugely powerful. Median pay, $45,000, half above, half below. Good sector for bringing people up into the middle class. Third, manufacturing. That's our problem. The United States has created 720,000 manufacturing jobs in January 2011 and January. California, we only had a 7% share. We have the largest industrial complex in the United States still, but it's not growing. Why? I speak a lot to groups over in Orange County that come in, they're manufacturers, they come to enjoy our weather, they come to enjoy the beach, they come to play golf, they go to the big hotels in Orange County, and I ask them, who in here is willing to take their plant and move it to California? And I've never had one of them say, me. They won't come. Why? Because of the environmental policy regulation that California created that basically says, don't come, we don't want you. Here's one of the offsets, or the results of our policies. Electrical costs, 14.0 cents per kilowatt hour. These yellow bars are how much more expensive California is than every other state west of the Mississippi. Right behind California is North Dakota. We're only 62% higher than North Dakota. Next to us, Arizona, we're only 66% more expensive than Arizona. Go down a couple, you find Nevada in there, and we're 80% higher than Nevada. There are consequences of that, and it discourages the expansion of manufacturing in this state. By the way, doesn't hurt the manufacturers that didn't come. It hurts the workers whose jobs were never created. These are the policies of, quote, Democrats. I hate everybody. 5.5% of our job growth was in this particular sector. Median pay, $50,000. Construction. What's going on in this, in the housing industry in general? Here's what's happened to home prices. They peaked at 368. They bottomed at 134. 200,000 is where they sit, or 280,000 are up 109%. San Bernardino County numbers, Riverside are similar, only higher. But we're still about a peak. We don't have to get back to the peak. Why? Because if you look at this black line and everything above it, those are the houses that were sold during the bubble. In crazy time. Most of those have already been lost. So, in terms of advantage for new and existing homes together, San Bernardino County, 295, Riverside County, 348. How does that compare to the coast? 552 in LA, 561 in San Diego, and only 740,000 in Orange County. Half above, half below. So you see it down here at the bottom, what you save by migrating in here. So if we look at, say, Orange County, you save $445,000 on the middle-priced house. If you come to San Bernardino County, you save $387,000 if you come to Riverside County. Migrate inland. located. Please. This is what's happened to the size of the gaps. The size of the gaps between the coastal counties and here are getting wider. That red on top is the Orange County gap, which is up to over 400,000. The other two, the blue and the black, are up to 300,000. Those are the LA and San Diego gaps. They've gotten really wide. So you will see ultimately the markets, people reacting to this. Part of our price, frankly, is there's no inventory. This is new home inventory. It's the lowest it's been since all the way back in early parts of the last decade. In terms of notices of default, they are now lower than at any time until sometime before 2000. So that's out of the market. There's some increase in new family homes. It is not what's driving the, that's more infrastructure. Of all permits is back to the 1999 level. It's not inflation. So here's what we see in apartment rents. Consequence of having a lot. You'll notice Riverside is the lowest, followed by, but all of well over $1,300 a month and higher. The value is extremely low. This is what's going on in construction, our second fastest growing sector now, but not so much as a residential. It's mostly large projects, whether they're large buildings or freeway infrastructure and that sort of thing. 13% of our jobs, 1,000. Finally and last, we look at the high paying sectors that aren't medical. Here we have a real problem. The problem is bachelor's degree and above in the Inland Empire, 20%. Look at the coastal counties, and it's 30 to up to the Bay Area, it's 44. So we don't have a well-educated to draw high-end companies into this region. Our office market is doing better. Net absorption is up to something that might be considered normal. It had exploded during the period of the boom, then it died, and it's come back to sort of a relatively normal area. Vacancy rates have dropped from 24% down to 12%, but that's still pretty high. E-commerce is an issue here, frankly, because with e-commerce, you don't need as much office space. You can do it all, I think you can practically buy a house on your cell phone now. Lease rates then are down. They are 8.2% below the peak back in 2007, though they are 12% above the low. These are all the sectors that are high-end sectors that aren't medicine. And which in the private sector, it's only 1.6%. So very small piece for us. All our high-end really is in healthcare. Median pay is great, $71,000, but we're not creating a lot of that kind of work. Now, when we look at the other piece that pays a lot, it is government. However, both the president and the House Majority Leader, or the Speaker of the House, both of them would like to see government shrink, but defense expand. We do have the advantage here of the Marines and 29 Palms, Fort Irwin for the Army, March Air Reserve Base for the Air Force, and the Naval Surface Warfare Center in Corona, which is really high-end. They do a lot of really technical stuff there. Those are going to expand. When we look at assessed valuation in the two counties, it is up in San Bernardino County by 14% over what it was before the recession. Inflation is up 11.7%. So it's beaten inflation, so the purchasing power for San Bernardino County from the assessed valuation has gone up. I don't have the chart for Riverside, but it's up 10%, so it's up less than the inflation rates and not quite as fast. There is what's going on with federal, state, and local government from the turnaround through last year. It is still negative. They have not gotten back to where they were beforehand. Median pay in government, $60,000. Now, what's going to happen in retailing is retailers are going to get hurt. Iddo laid it out, absolutely accurate, totally agreed with him. The fact is, you're going to see a lot of retail malls fail, and retail sales are switching over into the e-commerce world. This is what you're seeing in retail vacancy rates. They're higher in the Inland Empire, almost double what they are in the coastal counties. You're also seeing lower asking rents, triple net, here versus the coast. These are all the low-paying sectors. They add up to 38, 39, 40% of our economy, smaller than what you see in the state as a whole. Now, summarizing this all together. One, the Trump impact that I've outlined just a little bit here will not be, except for rising interest rates. They'll mostly affect 2018. Healthcare is very strong, but we'll have to see what they do to the ACA, what happens to that piece of legislation that went in yesterday. Logistics is strong, but it's under the tariff threat or the tax bill threat. Manufacturing is strong, except we're in California. And so all the things you might want to do really get bottled up there. Infrastructure construction, that's a place we should see a lot of strength. But you got two problems. One, CEQA. How long does it take to get permits to do anything in California when anybody and their uncle can sue? Ask Iddo. Iddo used to have no gray hair. That was about a year ago. The residential market is stabilized. It could be hurt somewhat by rates. Industrial construction is strong, but under tariff threat or the tax bill threat because of what could happen to imports. Office market is weak due to e-commerce and high vacancy levels. Retailing has had modest growth, but again, it's under threat from particularly e-commerce in terms of employment. Altogether, the forecast I have, a preliminary working the numbers, I just got this stuff yesterday. I look at this year 42.5, which is a 3% job growth. This year we did over 4, and unemployment of 5.6%. This is my website. This will be posted, if I can get my website manager to get it up. The only problem I have with him is he spends a lot of time in Coachella ever since they decided to legalize pot.
Coming on after John is always interesting because obviously we have our presentations overlap at some level. I think there's going to be slight difference in focus on this particular one. I'm going to talk about, there we go, I think he's going to, I think we both have visions of what's the future and what's happening out here in the IE and what's happening in terms of real estate. Of course, we'll just base a conversation about forecasting, right? Because we all have forecasts, we all talk about the future. Realize forecasting's tough. Yogi Berra famously said, forecasting is difficult, particularly the future. And, I like to point out that I've never made forecasts in my entire life. Every forecast I've ever made is wrong. Now, mind you, I'm a very good forecaster because I'm less wrong than the vast majority of forecasters. So that's the kind of bar I'm dealing with there. Now, mind you, I'm not the only forecaster who has a tough life. I mean, look at weather forecasters, right? Last year was supposed to be wet. Remember that, huh? And this year, well, dry. Oops, got that one completely wrong. And then last but not least, let's not forget, of course, the political forecasters. Morning of November 8th, this is Nate Silver, 38 website. For those not familiar with Nate, gold standard in many ways for political forecasters. Morning of, he said 71% chance of a Hillary, and it turns out that was quite wrong. Now, I'm not dishing on Nate too much, but I'll tell you why. Even he was running numbers and coming up with probabilities, in his own blog post, he was saying something's weird. Something doesn't seem right. Something doesn't feel good. And, of course, the result of the conversation was, as it turns out, those numbers were wrong. A lot of people voted who nobody expected. Of course, we ended up with a Trump win. Now, I woke up on November 9th, cold sweat, Okay, but never mind. The gaslighting, I had to face fundamental reality, because my conversation about the outlook for the economy has been largely based on the idea that Clinton was going to win. I was kind of building this probability into my forecast, and that really means 4 years of kind of the same old, political gridlock, continuation of basic policies. November 9th, I woke up, and I realized, world, we're going to have an extreme shift in policies, and that's going to have very real implications for the economy, things that we have to worry about. Now, of course, I have questions. We're, 3 months into this, and a lot of everybody says, what does it mean? What does it mean for the economy? And I have said the same thing. The election of Trump to the United States of America completely changed our outlook for the nation. We're just not quite sure how yet. Which is not an incorrect line. What that means, what we're primarily dealing with, and everybody in this room needs to be cognizant of, what we're really dealing with here is a massive increase in uncertainty. There is not so much been a big change in actual point forecasts, forecasters, but rather the potential ups and the potential downs have become much bigger. Is there some potential upsides, administration, of course? Is there some potential downsides? Oh, yeah. What I'm going to talk about today is really three things. A, I want to talk about where the election came from. It's important to understand how this victory arose. Second thing I'm going to do is talk a little about current conditions, not only, of course, in the nation, but here in the state, here in the Inland Empire, and talk a little bit about directions in the residential real estate market. And then last, but least, we're going to come back to Trump and talk about the potential that Trump has for the economy moving forward and what it may mean to you in terms of your business over the course of next year. So everybody got that? All right, good. So we'll go right back. What? How did this happen? You pick up any newspaper, and this is the ongoing mantra. Paper after paper, news outlet after news outlet, when they talk about the victory of Trump, they call it the anger of the electorate. People are pissed off. And the electorate of Trump was all about that anger. Why are they angry? Well, you heard about it over the course of this campaign. American families, no raise in 15 years. Crushing burden of the Affordable Care Act. Secular stagnation, declining productivity. Excessive taxes reduce business investment. Crime on the rise. Energy sector hurt by ridiculous regulations. Immigrants stealing U.S. jobs. Record numbers of discouraged workers. Income inequality at high levels. Federal debt out of control. Fed holding rates dangerously low. I didn't even think about this, right? This is some scary stuff. Some scary stuff. Now, we talk about the anger of the electorate. Well, I think last year I explained to you the true reality of the anger of the electorate. You remember this? People always talk about anger of the electorate. Well, what's the reality? I can sum it up in one word. Remember that word? It's a great word. Miserableism. Miserableism. That's what really sums this up. Miserableism. Miserableism, of course, is a philosophy of pessimism, or, as I like to put it, desperately trying to make things much worse than they actually are. Think about it for a second. We, the United States of America, sitting around, wringing our hands, feeling terrible for ourselves. Every time you pick up a paper, you hear another sob story about some terrible tragedy in some town somewhere in America. The entire campaign of Donald Trump was wrapped around the idea, make America great again, because Lord knows we're not great now. Really? Now, this idea of miserableism, how have we gotten here? Well, I like to point out, miserableism is, in many cases, a winning strategy. It's a profit-making enterprise. And we always have to remember that. I take, for example, some of my favorite miserableists, Louis C.K. He's a miserableist, right? Everybody see Louis C.K. do a stand-up? Very funny. What is he talking about? How terrible his life is. Makes lots of money. Lots and lots of money. Talk about terrible life is. Wall Street's a miserableist. They love bad news. Why? This creates market volatility, which in turn creates, of course, more trading. Trading drives commissions, which drives profits. They love bad news. The news networks. Biggest miserableists out there. Why? At some point in time, in the last 10, 15 years, some MBA working for the news network sat down and I did a little correlation. Turns out a lot more people watch our news networks when bad stuff is happening. So therefore, every time you turn around, they're screaming, crisis! Does anybody watch like CNBC or CNN on a regular basis? How many times have you seen the word crisis over the course of the last 2 years? 7,000, 8,000 times, I don't know. What was funny, probably the most funny thing I've ever heard, remember Brexit last year? The shrieking hysteria around Brexit was truly awe-inspiring. It was nonstop coverage. When they voted to leave the European Union, every news network was covering it 24 hours, shrieking at the top of the hills. Ah! Now, I can be honest with you. Do you want to know what if you actually sit down and look at the underlying dynamics, do you know what Brexit means for you and your business? Nothing. Totally irrelevant. It means nothing to the U.S. economy, nothing to the California economy. You would never have guessed that. And then, of course, the miserablest in chief himself. A man whose primary asset on the campaign trail was not that he was the only miserablest, but he was the best miserablest. Because in reality, Bernie Sanders is no different. Don't kid yourself for a second. Bernie Sanders and Trump are very similar. They're both screaming about the end of the world and how terrible our economy is. Now, they blame completely different forces. Trump says it's the terrible taxes and the terrible regulations, and Bernie Sanders says it's those evil corporations and rich people. But they're still painting the same picture of a U.S. economy in decline. Well, folks, take a step back. In fact, I go so far as to say, and I know this is shocking, they're actually pretty good. They really are. Take GDP. All right, I know. I'd love to have 3.5% of GDP growth. I'm sure you would too, right? But you know, we've been growing about 2%. That's not too bad. We've been a little bit of ups, a little bit of down. And candidly, it's been a rough few years. Been all sorts of problems with the global economy, and we've managed to muscle our way through. More importantly, no chance of a downturn. You know, things I've been hearing lately. Well, you know, we're 7 years into an expansion. Therefore, a recession must be going to happen any time now. Because the average expansion is only 7 years. So we got to be near to the end of this. That's stupid. It's just stupid. It doesn't work that way, folks. Expansions, economic expansions, are not like people. They aren't like born and they're young and they're strapping and healthy. And then they get, you know, in the middle age and get a little achy. And then they get funny smelling and old and then they die. Doesn't work like that. Doesn't happen. All right? Every economic expansion is permanent until it's cruelly murdered by some negative shock to the system. If you are predicting a recession, you have to tell us what the negative shock is going to be. And there's nothing within the economic fundamentals of our economy today that would suggest any kind of economic downturn in the next couple years. Now, there are risks, but the risks don't come from the fundamentals. The risks come from some dramatically negative change in government policy coming out of the Trump administration. But as for the fundamentals of the economy itself, it's fine. Do we as a nation really suffer? We're home to 5% of the global population. We also represent 20% of... You get that? 5% of people, 20% of consumption. In other words, we're the biggest group of spoiled brats on the planet. Just once, I'd like to hear a presidential candidate sit on stage and tell people that. Shut up and stop whining. Because we have it really good compared to most any place else in this world. Stop feeling sorry for yourself. Okay? It's like that rich kid who's whining because he didn't get the Porsche he wanted for his 16th birthday. Oh, I'm so sorry for you. Real incomes have been rising. True well-being even more so. Labor markets are tight. This is one of the ongoing nonsense. This idea, this concept, that there are millions of discouraged workers in the Midwest, these herds of blue-collar workers, like the buffalo of yesteryear, roaming the Midwest, desperately searching for a factory to give them a job. Utter nonsense. This does not exist. Inflation is still low. Interest rates are still low. Business investment is solid. Profit high. Making tons of money. U.S. energy, biggest problem they have, too successful for their own good. And, of course, manufacturing, doing fine. California, remember our state, most business unfriendly in the nation, yet we're ahead of the game. Now, there's not saying there's not problems. There's plenty of problems. The slow growth is in large part to do with self-inflicted wounds in terms driven by this preposterous ultra-right and ultra-left people that don't have a clue how the real world works. The economy has been weak, driven in large part by, of course, the big domestic, the energy glut that has hurt many economies, not the least of which is Texas. There's been a big slowdown in business investment wrapped around the energy sector. Of course, state and local budget. That's one of the things that's frustrating to me. 7 years of revenue growth for local governments. Talk to any city or county in California. They're stressed. They feel like they're in a recession, even though there's 7 years of revenue increases. What's going on? Pensions. Which, of course, these are the real problems having to do with pensions and various sorts of entitlements, at least in Medicare. We have problems with finance. After on Dodd-Frank's, and overall,
a very slow recovery that continues in the housing market. We have growing wealth inequality. But the thing that scares me most of all is, again, this. I understand politics and economic reality, they don't get along well. Because politics is about, shall we say, massaging the truth for your own particular political benefit. But never have I seen the disconnect between political discourse and reality been as great as it is right now. And if anything else, what comes out of this conversation, the data I'm about to throw at you, is that reality. I mean, your clients are asking you about this stuff, and they're wondering how terrible things are. I think you need to tell them the hard truth. It's not that bad. We're doing okay. In fact, I'd rather live here than pretty much any place else on the planet. So, really, stop whining, America. Just stop whining. Just for a couple minutes. Now, where does all this optimism come from? We'll just start with GDP. This is year-on-year growth from real GDP. You can see there's ups and downs. We get to 3% growth, then we slow down, pick up, slow down. Each one of these little slowdowns we've seen here has to do with some negative shock to the system. The last time around, late 14 into 2015, for a few quarters, we were growing 3% year on year, pretty good. And then, again, we started to slow down. This time, again, as already noted, the global commodity glut. Big collapse in energy prices, big collapse in British commodity prices. You saw a number of developing economies go into recessions. Brazil, for example, Russia basically stopped growing. Middle East had all sorts of issues going on. Texas, North Dakota, they saw a big slowdown, big pullback in business investment. Exports slowed down. But we continue to muscle through. We continue to grow. And if you look towards the end of the year, we started to pick up speed again. Why did we pick up speed again? Because the global commodity glut started to work its way out of the system. Exports the second half of the year started to pick up yet again. Overall, industrial production for mining started to pick up again. Corporate profits started to bounce back. All the symptoms of that glut started to work their way out, and lo and behold, the U.S. economy started getting moving again. And you certainly see it. Take, for example, the ISM indices, the Institute Supply Management Diffusion Index, above 50 means growth. You can see for both manufacturing and non-manufacturing getting up into those higher levels, all predictions of expansion coming in 2017 was pretty good. We were moving forward. And of course, through all this turmoil, the ongoing biggest source of stability in the U.S. economy has been the consumer. Consumer continues to increase their real spending on the basis of 3% on a year-on-year basis, and they're spending it for the right reason. People continue to spend more money because they are earning more money. This is not 2006, where people are borrowing money against their own inflated home and using it to buy all sorts of gifts. This is spending on the basis of income growth because savings rates themselves remain actually steady. Consumers are spending more because they're earning more. And they're earning more because the labor markets are pretty tight. You look, this is the overall number of payroll jobs. It continues to be nice and positive. Yes, in 2014 and 15, we ran about 250,000 jobs a month. Now we're kind of in that 175,000 range, a little bit of a slowdown. But the slowdown we're seeing is not because of lack of labor demand. If you look at the job openings rate, it's on an all-time high level. Some sectors more than others, some of the biggest needs right now in employment are professional services and healthcare. Construction's a little bit low, manufacturing's a little bit low. But overall, one of the highest rates of job openings we've seen. The reason there's been a slowdown in job growth is in large part it's becoming harder and harder to find the right people to fill those jobs. You know how tight labor markets are right now. Oops. Unemployment rate. I can go ahead and the unemployment rate now. Sorry, hang on. This thing's going the wrong way. Hello. Can you back this thing up, folks? Yeah, right to the left on the right, left button. Ah! Right button. All right, I'm coming. Yeah, all right, I got it.
Brian is probably in the room.
Got it. Congratulations, by the way. Sorry, here we go. All right. Good. I got it. Sit up. Someone's messing with me here. I think the battery might be going on this thing. Okay. So look at the unemployment rate, right? The unemployment rate on the U.S. is about 4.5.
Including discouraged workers, the so-called youth, that's something like 9.2%, all falling radically. And, you know, well, it may be all well and good, but, you know, things are still bad. There's all sorts of workers that aren't being counted. Well, again, another side of a tight labor market.
Median wages growing close to 3%. These are real numbers. Last year and a half, workers have seen real increases in their income growth. You guys don't need to take pictures. These slides are going to be posted, and we're going to have a video as well, so. I'll just give you address when we come to that and something. In terms of labor force growth, that's starting to pick up again because wages are you're pulling people back into the labor market. That's a good sign there. Social Security disability insurance, that's the new welfare. You know, ever since we had welfare reform, welfare is no longer as generous as it once was. We now have a new welfare. It's going on Social Security disability. And that, of course, peaked at close to 9 million people. Well, the last 2 years has been falling. People are leaving Social Security disability. That's one of the best signs of all. These are all indications of the labor market nice and tight. There we go. Now, what about that participation rate? This, I think, is probably one of the most misinterpreted data points we have out there. Constantly, people are looking at this. Now, mind you, I've heard that one of the lines that Trump uses, there's like 90 million people out of work in the United States. You know, where the hell did he get that number? Well, what he looked at was all the working-age adults who aren't in the labor force. Now, by the way, most of those people who aren't in the labor force don't want to be in the labor force. They've retired early, they're stay-at-home parents, they're at school. There are people who, for any number of reasons, never wanted to work. The peak of participation, by the way, among working adults was 84%. We saw that in about 2000 or so. And since then, this 25 to 50-year-olds. The overall number is lower than that. Look at 25 to 50-year-olds, that's gone from 84% down to 81%. And I think it was this ongoing conversation. Participation rates are lower, and that must be where all these people are kind of, not existent in the workforce. Again, it becomes part of the miserableism conversation. The problem here is that, first of all, that started back in 2000. It didn't start in 2006. And the second problem is this was predicted somewhere around 1980. Because the vast majority of declines in participation rates is not due to a lack of labor demand. It's due to basic demographic changes within our economy. That is to say, we have an aging workforce, we have changing demographics out there. I played a little game. I took the 2000 participation rates and I applied it to today's adult population, which of course include those 15 years of changes. And this is what's amazing. It turns out if you take the 2000 participation rates by age, by level of education, by gender, and you apply it to today's adult population, the labor force would drop by a million people. It wouldn't go up. We wouldn't have more people employed. We'd have fewer people employed. Now, that kind of blows me away. I can't understand that. But you got to understand there's been some big shifts out there. Look, our blue-collar workers on the outs, yes, some of them are. If you look at younger blue-collar workers under 54, you got about 2 million males who are now in the workforce who would have been in the workforce had we had a 2000-type economy, and about a half million females as well. So that's 2.5 million people. But what we forget about is if you look at the increased participation rates for educated workers, which is way up, for female workers, which is way up, and perhaps most of all, the 55-plus range, because people are working longer than ever before, that adds about 3.5 million people. So on net, we're about a million jobs ahead, not behind. Now, yes, there's still 2.5 million adults on the outside. To put that in context, that's not 40%. That's about 1% of the working age population. And those jobs haven't been stolen by Mexico. They haven't been stolen by China. For the most part, they just shifted to older, more educated workers. So something we need to pay attention to, but this idea that this is a core problem in the U.S. is just false. That problem does not really exist. And even, locally, maybe California and New York is fine, but the Midwest has collapsed. I gave a talk to a whole group of upstate legislators, including the folks in Wisconsin, and they were talking about that. Oh, your data is good, but Wisconsin's doing terrible. Oh, really? Are they? Yeah, absolutely. That's why they went for Trump, anger of the electorate, right? It's terrible out there. Oh, here are so upset in Wisconsin? Because they live in Wisconsin. Which, again, is kind of not really, it's actually, I know this sounds funny, but I'm actually being serious. See, here's the problem you have in a place like Wisconsin, people are moving away. The population is growing very fast because people are choosing. They don't want to live in Wisconsin, they want to live in Arizona, they want to live in California, they want to live in Texas, they want to live where it's warmer. And people are moving away from those areas. And that is a problem. That's one of the reasons labor markets are so tight, because people move away. But they're moving away because they don't want to live there. They're not moving away because they don't have opportunities. That is not what's happening out there right now. How about this idea of income stagnation? This, to me, again, represents, I think, one of the ongoing complete misunderstandings of government. You can go online and you will find, oh, I don't know, 10,000 web pages devoted to this particular statistic. This is real average household incomes. And again, website after website after website devoted to this picture, all sorts of political conversations devoted to this picture from the left to the right. What happened? Incomes for households grew up to about 2,000, and they've been flat ever since. And yes, we got a big bump in 2015, but the miserable says, yeah, we just got above the 2,000 level. Terror. Americans are suffering. Absolutely. Again, the left talks about it because of inequality. The left talks about it because of corporations and a busted political system. The right, oh, it's all about taxes. It's all about regulations, killing the productivity of the U.S. economy. I have the real answer. It's neither the left nor the right. The real answer is this data is wrong. You see, read the fine print. Turns out that this information is collected from your gross adjusted income on you put on your IRS form. Oops. Your adjusted gross income. That misses all sorts of income, folks. Healthcare. If government or private health by your employer, not counted. Pensions payments, not counted. There's a litany of reasons why that is just out. Having kids pushes it down. It's because of your write-offs. This is not an accurate representation of people's true well-being. Now, we have a better data set, by the way, comes from the VA. It includes all forms of income. And if you look at that, a pretty similar number, you get maybe a slightly different picture. Looks something like this. Oops. Yes, it rose, flattened out a little bit of the Great Recession. Since then, it's been rising, and now it's much higher, not only than it was a few years ago, it's much, much, much higher than it was back in 2000. We aren't suffering, and this makes sense. You know, how many people have heard this survey? Millennials are going to be the first generation that has a worse standard of living than their parents. Have you heard this? Does that make any sense to you? Really, just take a deep breath. How can any journalist say that out loud without giggling? Millennials are going to have a worse standard of living? How? Because these income numbers don't even capture what's going on. What's better today? The answer is pretty much everything. We'll start with communication. This is one of my favorite things to talk about, communication. You know, here's one of the issues with GDP. You know, used to be, this is a big change. I got a one-year-old home, okay? That was my big change from being here last year. Grandma's in Japan. If grandma, 30 years ago, 25 years ago, wanted to know how our kid was doing, you know what she'd do? She'd make a phone call. And she'd say, hey, how you guys doing? Is the boy alive? He's doing great. She'd be, oh, great, thanks. Love you, click. And that would be like $32. Today, she has an iPad. We have an iPad. We FaceTime, and she sits there and plays. She plays with her grandson for an hour for free. By the way, that's not counting GDP anywhere. How about medical care, pharmaceuticals, the range of pills and products we have, the ability to extend people's life, the ability to make your life better? Not included in the statistics. None of these numbers are there. Entertainment options. When I was a kid, we had four channels. Four. I heard some smart guy from McKinsey sitting next to me going, oh, yeah, I understand. I understand why people are angry. I'm from India. I know I have a better life than my parents. We live in India. I picked up the phone, and half the time I didn't have a dog at all. Americans don't see that. I turn around and I go, kids in America don't know what a dial tone is. What are you talking about? transportation, the cars we have, magnificent shopping options. We used to have to find things by shopping from store to store. I told my wife this year, honey, I'm going Christmas shopping. Don't open my office door. I didn't go anywhere. It was great. Food quality, variety, environmental conditions, legal marijuana. Nothing is worse. I take it back. There's one thing worse today. The stones. That's it. Everything else is better. Stop with the nonsense. Stop. Just stop. You know what scares me? Not inequality. Not wealth, not income inequality. If you actually look at taxes paid, benefits received, income inequality is much less than Bernie Sanders did, and it's not rising nearly as fast. You know what does scare me? Wealth inequality. The fact that 90% of Americans have less net worth in 2013 than did in 2001. The fact that 75% of Americans have less, about half of Americans have less net worth than did in 1989. That just scares you to death. No one's talking about that. No one's talking about wealth inequality. The left is running around whining about a minimum wage. That doesn't fix this. This is much more complex, and no one's talking about it. We're missing the boat completely. How about housing? Same old, same old. Not too hot, not too warm. Sales, not great, but moving forward. Prices, not great, but moving forward. A little shift. Overall, construction's not very good. But 2015, most recent numbers, we did see a slight uptick in people owning homes. That's all good news, but nothing too exciting. Nothing too exciting there. How about here in California? Around residential, what's up as well? Decent numbers. Everything's moving forward. It's hard to find anything truly bad. California, 2016, CEO survey. I love this. I love this survey. Every year it comes out, and here we go. 2016, best and worst states to do business. California, number 50. Worst state to do business. Give it up, guys. Come on. What's on the list? I'm seriously. By the way, 12 years running. Dynasty, baby. Beat that, Lakers. Come on, bring it. I laugh. Why? Because it doesn't matter. Look, I don't like this business unfriendly state. I wish we were more business friendly. Why? I'm a business person here. I deal with the nonsense. You know, and it's a pain in the butt. But I'll tell you the truth. I'm not moving to Texas. Sure as hell I ain't moving to Wisconsin. I'd much rather live here, and apparently I'm not the only one. Over the last 3 years, California is responsible for 1 out of 6 jobs in the United States of America. 1 out of 6 here in California. Our economic output grew faster than the national average by a good margin. And this isn't new. For the last 20 years, we've added 35% to our payroll workforce, 25% for the nation and world. Unemployment right now in the state, basically at the national level. Today, California's share of national income, never been higher. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't make the state more business friendly. We should. But we should make it do it for us. It's not a growth conversation. It really is not a growth conversation. How about different kinds of employment? Well, here's the numbers. A little bit slowed down towards the end of the year. We're over on the right-hand side, about 2% growth. The same slowdown here we've seen in other places. A lot of it simply has to do with the fact that we're, running out of extra workers. Where is the growth? I love these numbers. These are the revised numbers. And yes, your eyes do not deceive you. Go way down the list. These are major times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 7 and 8. 7 and 8 ranking year-on-year growth, San Jose and San Francisco. Number one in the state for growth over the last year, Modesto. The Depression era economy called the Central Valley, number one in growth. Inland Empire, number two, 3.2%. Woo! Fresno, number three. Oakland, East Bay, Ventura's up there, Stockton's up there. Folks, inland areas are where the growth is occurring right now. Again, it's not the coastal communities. Inland areas. And you know why? A lot of it has to do with cost of housing, affordability. People are moving out here. Jobs are forming out here. No doubt about it. What kind of jobs? Well, a mix. Education, you have information, healthcare, logistics, special scientific service, a lot. Near the bottom, manufacturing, we want some. Absolutely. The nation has overall about 0.4%, not too bad. And then sports slowdown, retail sales slowdown. A lot of good jobs there. And of course, this is another thing. What are bad jobs? Well, I guess it's good jobs now. A lot of bad jobs. percentile, by far and away, the biggest percentile is in the higher end, and of course, in the lower end, it's a little lower percent growth overall. This is good numbers. These are good numbers. Lots of people making more income out there. We should be happy about this. Travel tourism is doing great. Taxable sales continue to move forward. As for local jobs out here in the IE, getting very good. Logistics, top of the list. About 100,000 jobs, up 7.4%. Construction, number two, 6.9. Leisure, hospitality, restaurants, other services, healthcare, government, financial activities coming forward. Manufacturing, 2.7% out here. 2.7% growth in manufacturing. One of the few places where you're seeing significant increases in manufacturing jobs. And yes, there's been an increase in establishments out here as well. Manufacturing is coming to the Inland Empire. And it's doing fine. It's doing fine. It's a pretty good point in time. Lots of good numbers here. And of course, if you see on the right, how much farther ahead the Inland Empire is compared to Los Angeles and California overall. And of course, even more importantly, is employed residents. Remember, there's a big difference between payroll jobs, which are people who work here in the Inland Empire, versus household jobs, which are for people who live here in the Inland Empire, even if they happen to work in Orange County, San Diego, or LA. Right now, 1.9 million employed residents of the Inland Empire. To put that in context, from a labor force perspective, the Inland Empire is the 13th largest economy in the nation, folks. Number 13 on a labor force basis. There are a lot of people here. You exist in an enormous economy. The reason people don't realize it, it's a weird enormous economy because there's no work for them. Very strange. Some of the work we're doing right now at UC Riverside, part of my new position, is talking about that, talking about the issues. And how do we create urban corridors? Because right now, the one thing the IE really needs to formalize its role as a general standalone economy is to get away from being a veteran community and start having these urban corridors. The two places that make the most sense, Ontario and the city of Riverside. And I think they're moving forward. And again, from an income perspective, well, we're all bad jobs. Again, no. This is a change in households by income 2010-2015. And yes, the single largest increase in households are those making over 100K a year, up 30,000 households from 2010. Number two is the 75K, the 100K range, then the 25 to 50K, and households making less than 25 has dropped. There's no massive increase in inequality. A lot of people are doing better out here because of all the wonderful opportunities available to us. Now, single largest issue we're dealing with? Quiz time. And then this is interesting. This is a matching game. Remember this back in elementary school. Real simple quiz. You got letters and numbers, and I need you guys to match these up. On the right-hand side, five parts of the state. Bay Area, Central Coast, Greater LA, Greater Sacramento, South Central Valley. By the way, Greater Sacramento, South Central Valley, that's the dividing line to Fresno. Fresno down south, Modesto north is north. You got that? Left-hand side, 20-year growth rates for jobs. And it's, the lowest is 23.6%. The highest is 40%. You got it? All right, pen and paper, match. Don't be looking at your neighbors. I swear, I'll throw you out of class. All right, time out. What did you put down for the Bay Area? What letter? You put down A. Interesting. Anybody else want to take a hazard a guess? C? Anybody else? B, okay. How about South Central Valley? What do you think? E? What the hell, you guys cheated? Did they give this quiz last year? Oh, I did? Oh, damn it. I really gotta renew my slides once in a while. All right, well, the answer is they're lined up perfectly. Yeah, so over the last 20 years, the Bay Area is the slowest growing part of the California economy, which boggles people's minds, because I thought the Bay Area had everything. They got this high-tech clusters. They got hordes of over-entitled, spoiled-brat, over-educated millennials. Oops, did I say that out loud? I meant to say over-educated, spoiled, latte-drinking. But they're just slowly part of the economy. And that's because what people don't realize is in the end, growth is not about clusters. It's not about full development. It's not about taxes and regulations. It's about bodies. It's about people. People is about housing. Single problem I have in California, you know this. We don't have enough housing. We don't build enough. We don't build enough because of all the NIMBYism, because of sequences, Prop 13, all these different reasons. And nowhere is the ferociousness of the opposition to housing worse than the Bay Area. Simple as that. And this is why I left. This is always this curious dichotomy. You go anywhere in the country, you got some development for
course next. We're going to be the next Silicon Valley. Yes, we're going to be the next. We're going to be the next computer hub. We're going to be the next software cluster. We want to be this. We want to be that. Every place in the country wants to be Silicon Valley, except for Silicon Valley. Where people protest Google buses, where they have riots in Oakland when every time a tech company comes across the bridge. Why are people so resistant? Because I'll tell you what. If there's a lack of housing, tech comes at everybody else's expense. And they realize that. They're getting pushed out. It's called gentrification. Gentrification is not a function of rampaging rich people. It's a function of the unwillingness of the local government to allow for the densification necessary to meet the needs of all. And in a very basic, in a very simple world, you won't build housing, the rich win, the poor lose, and that's that. Or another way of thinking about it, it's easy to be a liberal in San Francisco. All the poor people have moved away. Now, prices continue to rise, and nevertheless, we're hardly building any kind of new single-family units right now. The state's way down from where it was in 2005. There's lots of conversations about the affordability crisis, very few conversations about the supply crisis, which is where the problems actually exist. And of course, you can see it here in the IE. Prices have been rising, although, as already noted, John did a good job pointing this out, much cheaper along the coast. Overall, home sales continue to move along, not spectacular, a little bit of an uptick towards the end of last year. Things are okay on an overall basis. Inventories are still tight. But again, if you look at affordability, much better here than overall. Much better here, particularly on the ownership side, even though it's up just a little bit. Homes are still reasonably affordable right now. Here to the Inland Empire, to LA and Orange County, much better. You're bringing more and more folks in here. That's true on the rental side as well. Ownership remains relatively stable at this particular point in time, but still things are moving forward, good numbers across the board. But very little in the way of permitting. I actually think this is a relatively short situation. I think things are starting to move up again, and you're going to start seeing more people move out here and more construction. In the inevitability of the affordability issue, starting to push the activity out here, and you're starting to see not only jobs, and as a result of that, do expect you're going to see more people and more new home sales starting to move in the area, but it is going to be relatively slow. Non-residential continues to move up as well as the time. So, with all that in mind, things moving along at a pretty good pace, what does Trump mean? What does he mean for the economy? And I'll start with a conversation about manufacturing. Conversations about manufacturing to me continue to just boggle my mind. We want to bring back manufacturing jobs because that is how the middle class does great. Really? Well, first of all, we got to think about the fact that we still produce lots of manufacturing products. And again, it's one of the big myths. Every time you hear about the decline of manufacturing, they show jobs. Well, jobs is not analogous to output. Output is a function of jobs and machines. And of course, we have a big shift. You know, manufacturing output has grown more and less lockstep with GDP over the past last 25 years. A little bit slower in the last few years, but before they were growing higher. But again, big shift in the mix. Where do you produce more of now? Petroleum, motor vehicles, primary metals, other transportation chemical products. Kind of in the middle, electrical equipment, fabricated metal printing, a little bit of a slowdown there. And the bottom end, the stuff that truly has fled, stuff that's truly gone overseas, apparel, textile mills, paper, and furniture. Big mix and shift. Now, whenever you start talking about this idea, the blue collar, the great blue collar job of manufacturing, you know what they're talking about? They're talking about the UAW job. They're talking about those folks in Michigan. That was one of their jobs back in the day because that union was very powerful and had great benefits. Now, mind you, the union has been large and new because of the bankruptcies, the fact that they almost drove those companies into bankruptcy. And, of course, remember, actually, motor vehicle production is near an all-time high, actually an all-time high level in the United States. They haven't suffered. Those jobs have not gone to Mexico. They've not gone to Germany. They've not gone to Germany. China. Those jobs have been replaced by machines. And thank God for it. I see a few great here, folks. You guys had cars back in the 1980s, right? Built by UAW guys. I had one or two of those cars. They sucked. Because a hungover UAW worker makes a problematic car. Machines are never hungover. They're never angry at the boss. They've never been involved chit-chatting about whatever the Detroit Lions did the previous day while they should be paying attention to bolting your car together. Cars are much better, and those jobs ain't coming back. On the other side of the fence, what about apparel jobs? Has anyone ever been to an apparel factory?
this desire to bring back jobs that nobody really wants. It's not just manufacturing, by the way. I continue to laugh at this idea of coal. When I was a kid, we read books about how people had the most horrible, squalid lives in coal towns. Do you remember those books? Someone got out of a coal town. We use these words. They escaped. They escaped. That's how bad they were. Now we want to bring back those great jobs. What? But again, this is part of the miserables. How many people have seen one of these stories? They show some town on the Kentucky-Tennessee border, a town that's been devastated by Chinese trade, decline in the coal industry, and how terrible things are. You've seen these pictures, right? You've seen this, right? I have news. It always sucked to live in that town. Living in rural Kentucky was never fun. It was never good. Stop talking about this. It doesn't exist. I'll tell you what does exist, an enormous threat to our health for our economy. We are very trade dependent. 30% of our economy is made up of goods moving in and out of this nation. And by the way, exports are as important as imports, and exports in the last 15 years have grown much faster than imports, almost double compared to the 66% increase in imports. Our current account deficit is the smallest it's been since 1998. We don't have a problem. We're moving in the right direction. You cause a trade war, you're not going to bring back any good jobs. You're going to bring back a few lousy jobs, and you're going to threaten supply chains and create a recession. Single largest problem our nation faces, threat we face, is the idea of a major trade war. You want good news here? China faces it more than we do. They're more dependent on trade than we are. And hopefully they recognize that, because they don't. This can get ugly very quickly. How about the energy sector? I love this. We're going to bring back energy by deregulating it. Bring back energy? Does anybody know what the price of the pump is nowadays? It's cheap. You know why? U.S. oil. Fracking. Through the roof. In the peak a year and a half ago, we were producing 9.5 million barrels of oil a day. That's 20% more than Saudi Arabia, 25% more than Russia. We have 5,000 wells dug into the ground waiting for prices to hit $45 a barrel. They crack and start pulling oil out. No one talks about OPEC because no one cares. Because we are the new swing player. And this doesn't even include this. Largest oil deposit ever found the end of last year. 20 billion barrels of oil in West Texas, easily fracked. By the way, I'm glad about this. I'm a global warming believer. We got to wean ourselves off. That's going to take a little time, a little effort to do it. And in the meantime, better our oil than the Canadian tar sands. Better our natural gas than our coal. Because it's natural gas that's killing coal. No regulations. All this stuff is nonsense. Deregulating the energy, letting coal companies dump mountaintops into streams. It's not helping anybody. It's not changing anything. It's not creating any jobs. You're just making more profits for a few over-entitled CEOs. It's not helping anything. How about Dodd-Frank and banking? Well, here you go. This could make a big impact. Now, banks aren't being crushed. Overall, loan growth is up about 7% or so. But there's been, of course, a big issue in the housing market. We discussed this last year. The biggest issue you're facing for your clients, lack of credit availability for people who are slightly higher risk. And this, of course, is the lunacy of the left, because the left is not, lunacy is not exclusive to the right. The left has plenty of problems. And Dodd-Frank is a wonderful representation of that. If Dodd-Frank did fix what happened in the Great Down, the Recession, Dodd-Frank created a problem that didn't exist, which is that bank lenders are evil, and borrowers are innocent victims. It didn't address the actual problem, which was the subprime lenders out of Costa Mesa and the guys who aggregated and sold off to unsuspecting investors. That's the problem, not banks. Now, mind you, what they did was a witch hunt. They tried to take a liability foreclosure, take it off the lender, borrower, and put it on the lender. And what the borrower lenders did was pull away from people with credit scores under 720. Complete collapse in credit to those folks, down by two-thirds. Those above 720 do just fine. The housing market out here would be improved dramatically if they fixed Dodd-Frank to allow mortgages to start flowing again to higher-risk households. It would be very helpful to you, very helpful to the U.S. economy, very helpful to the conversation about wealth inequality. This is all good stuff. This is all good stuff. This could be a good positive place for things to start. All right, healthcare. They released their new healthcare plan last night. I don't know if you saw that. It looks suspiciously like Obamacare. The smartest guy I heard talking about the healthcare reform said this. He said, look, the biggest issue with healthcare is nobody wants to own it.
the other party knowing it because it's a no-win situation. Republicans figured that out. 50 times they want to get rid of Obamacare. I think at the very end, Obama should have, like, called their bluff. Okay. There you go. Get rid of it. All hell would have broken loose. Absolutely. 20 million Americans would have lost their health insurance. Even more, we're seeing substantial diminishment in the quality of their health care. And, okay, there's also economic implications. You know, we're always talking about manufacturing jobs. In the last 20 years, we've had 1.5 health care jobs per manufacturing job loss. And health care jobs are just fine, folks. It's a big sector. It's a growing sector. There's no problem here. Well, there is one problem. One problem is we're not actually talking about the health care crisis. You know, we always talk about Obamacare as if somehow it was health care reform. Again, a private lawyer I met said it's not health care reform, it's health care insurance reform. Completely different. We haven't had health care reform and we need it. The biggest problem in health care, the fact that we spend $9,400 per person per year in health care compared to, say, I don't know, $6,300 in Sweden or $5,400 in France. We spend vastly more of our income, on healthcare patients in the United States than any other countries without a significant increase in health quality outcomes. That's the problem, and no one's talking about that. No one's talking about the waste in the system, and no, this isn't lawsuits and overhead. This is just an over-prescription of services to people who don't really need it. No cost-benefit analysis, as simple as this. Now, Bailey, we better get serious about it, because, you know, the single largest threat to our fiscal health, and no one's talking about this, is Medicare. It's amazing to me. You know, as right-wing as Trump is, much like Medicare says, and Hillary couldn't agree more. We're not going to talk about Medicare reform. No, I'm not going to happen. I'm not going to talk about it. Really? You know, right now we have 45 million Americans on Medicare. Over the next 20 years, because the retirement boomer is going to go from 45 to 76 million people, 31 million new people on Medicare. To put this in context, right now Medicare eats up roughly 18.7% of federal revenues. By 2035, it's going to be 41%. And by the way, it has to compete with Social Security and Medicaid and defense spending. And how are they dealing with this? We're not going to touch it, and we're going to cut taxes. Really? The single largest threat our federal government faces, and we're ignoring it. This is broken. And of course, we don't worry about all the time about secular stagnation, slowdown growth. You know what one of the biggest contributors to secular, quote unquote, secular stagnation is? A slowdown in working age adults. I mean, no one talks about this, but half of economic growth is made up of workforce growth. Look at this is working age adults. Okay, this is just the number of people. Not even worried about labor force. You know, we used to grow about 2%. Right now, we're growing about 0.7%. Very slow because of an aging workforce, because we have fewer kids nowadays. By the way, this will be zero, but for, of course, immigration. Immigration is half of population growth in the United States right now. In 20 years, it'll be 2/3. Now, you want to talk about making Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid work. First thing you got to do is make sure we have enough working-age adults to fill up all those jobs. So, in other words, if you want to think about fixing Medicare, one of the things you can do is open the borders, bring all the immigrants in, and some more. Of course, we're not doing that. Instead, we've created a false problem. Immigrants are a problem. No, they're not. They're stealing American jobs. No, they don't. We've got 12 million undocumented people in this country, and we have a full labor market. That is a problem, isn't it? They're brown. We don't like those brown people. Really? I mean, it's nonsense. I mean, your points won't take it. That's a real issue. Now, by the way, California, we're comfortable with this. Why? 27% of Californians are born overseas. You know, I talked to my father not too long ago, a couple of years ago, and some census report came out. He said, by 2050, Caucasians will be minority in America. My dad was like, wow. You know, he's 81 years old to watch the Fox News, understand where he's coming from, right? Said, wow. And I go, well, what? He goes, that's crazy. I'm like, dude, I live in L.A. Welcome to my world, white boy. What are you talking about? I don't feel threatened. I don't feel marginalized. I feel great. Get over it. Well, we're used to it. The rest of the country's not. Yeah, there's a lot of nervousness about it. But they need to get over it. And understand the immigrants are a solution. No problem. How about taxes? We're going to cut taxes. Really? Why? Get a big boost to growth. No, you don't. Look, our laughter was a joke in the Reagan administration. It's just as big of a joke now. You don't get a lot of gains from cutting taxes. And mind you, I don't like paying taxes. I don't like it at all. I get pissed off every time I get a fill on my income tax form. I get it. But let's be honest. There's no magic bullet in the done. And besides, we're not paying that much. Look at corporate taxes. Corporate income is near an all-time high level. Corporate taxes pay stable loans about 25% of profits. It's lower than it was in the Reagan administration. You look at income taxes, about the same. We're not paying that much. I would like to pay less, but we got to cut back on spending. Where? They want to spend more on infrastructure. They want to spend more on defense. They're not going to touch Medicare, and they're going to take taxes. That doesn't work. It doesn't work. And by the way, investments near all-time high as well. Now, infrastructure investments, that would be huge for the U.S. economy. Huge. And I like the idea, but, you know, are they going to do it right? That's a big question. Sorry, I got ahead of myself here. You know, talking about tax credits, that doesn't work. Or for poor enough in total, it doesn't work for fixing the 10 and the 210. That's a big problem. I'm talking about it, but I hope they do it. But again, you can only spend more by raising taxes or, of course, by deficit spending. And that's one of the big worries, is if I can increase the deficit spending, which, of course, brings me to the asset markets. Because, you know, since Trump got an election, you see two major things. Interest rates come up. And mind you, 10-year round bond rates are 2.5%. They were higher in 2012, so not that high. And of course, stock market has also been going up. And this is interesting because the stock market seems to be remarkably blasé about Trump, which I don't fully understand. Well, I kind of do, because remember, stock market is pricing in a big cut in taxes, which is good for them. And of course, the bond market is calculating a big increase in borrowing. Now, should you be worried about this? Maybe, but not in the way you're thinking. You know, interest rates have been low for a while, and they're low in part because of the global supply glut. And we have a lack of inflation right now as well, which also contributes to low interest rates. And low interest rates have been a big source of support for the housing market. But they are starting to drift up because of the expectations of these things, and that's already starting to put a little bit of pressure on the market. But what worries me is what Trump might mean for the economy, and I'm not the only one, because if you didn't pay any attention, at the end of last year, the Federal Reserve raised rates, and they released this. They said, not only raising rates now, we expect a much stronger path of raising over the course of the next year, which is a surprise, because they hadn't said anything like that for the previous 2 years, even a really underlying growth conditions, underlying asset price positions, underlying money inflation conditions haven't changed. And all those conditions say you don't really need to be aggressive about raising rates, but now they are. Well, what they see is this strong fiscal stimulus in the context of a full employment economy. They see the potential for cutting corporate taxes and repatriating billions of earnings in the context of an already capital stuffed U.S. economy. This will unleash another financial bubble. Simple as that. We've been to two major financial bubbles, late 90s and middle part of last decade, both which are partially responsible for the very slow recoveries we've seen. The last thing this nation needs right now is a third major financial bubble cooking, and that's exactly where they are heading. And the Federal Reserve's not going to have it. So the biggest issue out there, I think, from your particular standpoint, is what happens if the Federal Reserve gets really aggressive and starts raising those rates and starts pushing the 10-year bond flat yield curve? Where you're going to make it more expensive to buy a home, and you're going to make lenders even less willing to lend because of flat yield curve. So if I said there's any one of the two major risks of the Trump administration, it's going to boil down to a trade war and the potential for a bubble, the Trump versus Yellen thing. So on net, I do think Trump is overall a negative for the economy. We're doing okay. There's positive things he can do. Perhaps Maddie broke the law jab. Thank God somebody's doing something. Infrastructure investments can be very helpful if they do it right. Tax cuts will give us a little modest bump, but remember, no long-term bullet there. Financial deregulation is probably the best place to have some advantage because you get more credit flowing, going to help a lot of people, going to help your market, get more people buying homes. We might have more balanced access to the Chinese market because the threats of a trade war might make them blink. And of course, we already sell a healthcare thing. I've always said this, Americans hate Obamacare, but it turns out they really like the Affordable Care Act. And that is, of course, becoming obvious in the context of the fact that they have not gotten rid of it. They're just making some changes. They could end up being positive in the long run. But remember, we still have to deal with the big issue, which is Medicare. As for the negatives, inexperience, infighting, conflict of interest, deficit's going to widen, interest rates going to rise, potential for a major trade war, increase wealth inequality, Federal Reserve might seek control of Congress, major backward steps in immigration, which will worry everybody because that is part of your growing demand base. Backward steps, of course, misery of it. If he truly blows up, then I will give you three words that are more scary than President Donald Trump. President Liz Warren. Because the difference between Liz Warren and Donald Trump is they're both evil, but Liz is a lot smarter than Don. And her policies are no good, because they're the radical left policies, which are only going to replace radical right policies. Folks, we need to move the conversation to the middle. We need income moving to the middle. No, moving to the income. We need compromise to be a word that is part of politics, not opposition to politics. We need to get away from this ridiculous polarization where the debate is between people who are wrong on the left and people who are wrong on the right. There is an in-between. There is a right place to be. We're not going there. But if you listen to this guy talk and get involved, hopefully, maybe, we'll start moving in that direction. But the first thing you got to do is realize that the conversations we're having at the national level really aren't conversations based on reality. So I had to sum it up. We're going to have a good year. But watch out. There's some risks out there, things you need to pay attention to. So be happy, be healthy, and we'll see. Thank you very
much. I have a lot of respect for everybody that's on this panel. So how self-determining is demographics going forward? So we have this great group of people. Is that like, okay, you're going to have very slow growth for a very long time, or can it be, is it likely to be countered? And any of you guys are more capable of answering that than I am.
Well, I mean, the primary source of new population growth is immigration. Simple as that. Not only is that true from just a pure body standpoint, but immigrants tend to have more kids as well.
Yeah, but but as far as housing, they own the homes less often.
In the first generation, but of course a lot of it depends on who. If you look, half of immigrants in California are from Central America, and yes, they tend to have low skill levels and less likely to own. The other half are from Asia. And they're high income, highly educated, and they own lots of homes.
Okay, we're getting back. So we're going to fix the immigration. We're going to come to a deal, right? We're not going to say, okay, everybody out, but that's ridiculous. We're not going to do that.
You and Steve Bannon, from your mouth to Steve Bannon's ears, right?
Yeah, we're not going to do that. Okay.
There's also a misnomer. Everybody talks about immigration. It's always poor people. And if we look all about, well, Google, immigrants, Sun Microsystems, immigrants, Steve Jobs of Apple, the son of an immigrant.
Says the man with an accent.
Hey, folks, I'm a fourth-generation Californian. I'd like to congratulate all of you coming to my state.
Well, the reality is that the state, the location brings opportunity, like you said. You'd rather be miserable in California than miserable in Siberia, right? So it's also
Wisconsin, right?
So, you know, we've been blessed with the location. The population base gives tremendous economic opportunities. There's always been challenges. There's been challenges for thousands of years. And somebody, I would say, as the guy who invented the wheel was very smart. The guy who invented the other three was a genius. So we're inventing things here. And I think that's part of what's going to happen. And that's what's driving immigration. Immigrants don't come to a place where they can't get a job, right? They have that in their own country. So they come to places where there are jobs, and we are providing them. So I think overall we've learned the self-helplessness. Like everything is miserable, like you call it. What was that word? I can't even pronounce that. Immigrant, but I can't pronounce it. But the reality is that it's still a country and it's still a state where you can create your opportunities despite the challenges. I mean, we all complain, but at the end of the day we get there. So that's.
I apologize for the audio, guys. We're as good as we're doing. We seem to be failing with the audio here, so I apologize with that.
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
The economist. Everybody talks about immigration. A lot of the immigrants are doing sort of, you might say, the low end and part of the sector of the economy. I always thought there's an imputed tax they pay. In other words, if you pay somebody picking tomatoes $25 an hour, $30 an hour, you go to the market and pay, you know, $12 a pound. Now, 90 cents a pound. So the money you're not paying for all those goods, right, have been paid by the imputed rate you would have paid a fully
you know, entitled.
Well, okay, first of all, I mean, immigrants pay a lot of taxes, even if it's not maybe on like income tax,
sales tax, gas tax.
Exactly. And to your point, because they fill a lot of these roles in relatively large businesses, they make many of the goods and services we consume cheaper than they would be otherwise, and we should all be very happy about that. And, you know, the typical complaint, though, and I think this is where you're going, is this idea that, well, you know, we have to pay this money to put their kids in the school. Well, that's not an expense, that's an investment. Because by taking those kids and getting them educated and making sure they ultimately have good jobs, we're helping our overall growth of our economy. So that's good, that's an investment, that's how we think about the future. It's not an expense.
I agree.
Okay, so we've got that solved. it's going to be interesting to see how this shakes out. Okay, we have our first question on the audience.
Hi, first of all, thank you so much for coming today. I had a really great morning listening to you guys. My question would be, considering everything you said today, you know, jobs leaving, jobs potentially coming, the whole economic forecast, each of you had a different opinion, but I want to know, if I buy a multifamily today, what neighborhood within the Inland Empire do you think will produce a better outcome in the next 5 to 10 years?
I'll give you the best answer I have.
Okay.
If I knew that, I wouldn't tell you. I'd be out there buying the
I know. I'm asking you guys. So that's honestly, it's a real question, though, and I'd like an answer.
I
can say
this
from
my Where the best schools are.
It's obvious that that's where more opportunities are going to come, and, you know, people care about education. You know, I mean, just without knowing what specifically those might be, but if I had to choose,
But to your point, they're already expensive there. So really, the question is one of better return. Are you going to pay a higher price?
Expensive is relative. Look, I know people in New York that said they should have bought a building 100 years ago for $9. Nothing ever really gets cheaper. It goes from up and down. But the good areas get better. Bad areas sometimes stagnate.
And sometimes they get better, and you make the biggest return.
Yeah.
You're talking about San Bernardino, neighborhood.
Can I make one suggestion?
Yeah.
Okay. If you're going to buy units, I would buy at least something that's standalone where your management actually affects the outcome. If you buy a fourplex, let's say, with 20 other fourplexes, you can get defeated by doing everything perfect and being affected by the results of all those other little pieces where no one will come into a neighborhood because it's unsafe. Okay?
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I was wondering, with the expansion of the Panama Canal and the building of the new canal, with all the warehousing we have in Southern California, how is that going to be affected down the line?
Let me tell you the easy answer to that. The ship pulled into LA and Long Beach harbors at different times, called the Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin is an 18,000 TEU ship. That is, that one ship has 18,000 20-foot equivalent containers on it. That is the direction that the ocean-going vessels are going. That ship couldn't even start to get through the Panama Canal. That canal is already obsolete. Maximum TEUs going through it, I believe, is 13,000, might be 14,000. That's it. That's not where the fleets are going. So, first of all. Second of all, even if the stuff can get through there, it's at sea for a long period of time. Whereas when it's coming into LA Long Beach, it's a much shorter time frame for the supply chain managers to make a decision about where they want to send the goods in those containers when they arrive. And the onshore infrastructure here, whether it's the logistics, the warehousing facilities, the trucking, the rail, the airports, is by far the most sophisticated in the United States. So that we will do just fine. We may lose some of the low income or bulk types of cargo might go through the canal, but anything that any value in it that needs to move at any speed is going to come through here. That is not a difficulty, and even the Panamanian. When you go down and talk to the folks there, I talked to the person who's a consultant to the Panamanians. Their anticipated growth rate didn't change significantly with the expanded canal.
There's one thing that always gets me, maybe it's an immigrant, that in America history starts about 6 months earlier. We've been competing with the Panama Canal for about 100 years. It's not a new phenomenon. They widen it, there's bigger ships, there's more modernization. But we've been competing in that market. By the way, a little geography. How many nautical miles is it from China to the East Coast through the Panama Canal? Or how many nautical miles is through the Suez Canal? Another way to get to the East Coast. So it's 11,400 nautical miles for the Panama Canal, 11,700 nautical miles going through the Suez Canal. It's not something that's changing the world. It's changing some of the economics because the size of ships, the economics of shipping, a lot of things, but this is not going to be this big game changer in the West Coast.
One other fact that's important, excuse me, is as the exports move from China in the direction of India, India goes the other direction. They would be going through Suez. That would be a bigger threat than anything dealing with Panama Canal.
I have a slightly different answer, which is I don't think the ports are that big of a driver of the warehouses out here. Warehouses out here are mainly about distributing goods to the 50 million plus people who live in this sort of southwestern part of the United States of America. And on that basis, those people aren't going anywhere, no matter how big that canal is. So I still think that the port's impact on local industrial space is highly overstated. I would argue Amazon is going to be just as big of an impact on these distribution centers, particularly as we go to an economy where more and more of our products are getting dropped off their doorstep rather than being picked up at the local retail store.
By the way, $1 billion in sales, e-commerce, creates a demand for about a million square foot distribution center. And this thing is going at $40, $50 billion a year.
Oh, yeah.
So you're going to see 50 to 60 to 70 million square feet in demand simply by what's happening with e-commerce.
I apologize, I have to leave, folks. I got another meeting. But thank you very much for your time.
Thank you,
Chris.
I appreciate it. We do have time for a few other questions, but
I don't know. This screams Inland Empire to me. I have a Ford key on a Mercedes-Benz keychain. So if that happens to be you, then let me know. Also, real quick, in case I forget, we've been live streaming on Facebook the entire event. I think we lost a piece of it with the battery issue. So for those of you that missed something or heard something and want to hear it back, you can go to our Cold Banker Town Adventure Facebook page and you can watch, hopefully, all of it. And then I think with permission, I'm pretty sure everyone's going to say yes, we'll be able to put out PDF copies of the PowerPoint. So I've been getting a lot of inquiries about that, so we'll get that to you as well. And our next question.
Good afternoon. My name is Bobby, and this is my third year coming. I appreciate you guys coming every year. My question is, in the Inland Empire, predominantly that I see a lot of the loans are FHA. Do you see any, can you comment anything in regards to any conventional folks coming in? Because my experience has been it's predominantly FHA financing, and I didn't know if that was going to be a problem at all.
Well, one of the difficulties is, you bump up against the loan limit. And yeah, if we had a higher FHA loan limit, you'd certainly have more buyers. There was a program that I suggested when I spoke. It's hard to get it passed, just for the rest of the panel, just a nothing down loan program by Fannie Mae. Due to the median price of the area, have it be able to float to a new owner, and have a trustee sale not risk the principal, but only be sold for the back payments. You'd have a lot more volume. I'm really concerned that we're going to go below 60% in the next number of years in owner occupants, and I don't think that's great for our society, to be honest with you. And I'm an investor and a guy that's a landlord, but I'd rather not see the country's direction go that way.
Good afternoon, my name is Toyo.
He's a troublemaker.
So my question is for Iddo. This cluster, when is it going to happen? And when it does happen, if you're a developer, how do you plug in terms of surrounding development?
I'm sorry, I missed the first part.
The first part is the cluster you talked about.
The cluster.
Yeah, when is it going to happen?
it's a good question. We have all our approvals, but we're in California, so we have CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act. John is very familiar with it. It's a good thing when we're young when we started, because the closest I'll ever get to a kind of life is going through the process in California. We have our approvals. Now we're going through what typically happens is CEQA litigation. The only way to enforce CEQA in the state of California is through the courts. So everybody has a free call. We have settled most of the big issues. We're now left with a few groups that I would say sort of environmental concerns that I think have very little to do with the environment, protecting the environmental resources, but everything to do with advancing some of the agendas. At best case, it probably happens in a few months. At worst case, it probably happens within a year or two.
So when it happens, how long will it take to build out?
It's a very good question. We've been looking at this. We've had demand of over 10, 11 million square feet today. We cannot deliver it because we're in CEQA litigation. The growth projections, and one thing that people don't understand, we're running out of land for this type of development. The World Logistics Center is about, in another 1 or 2 years, will be the only place where you can really build any of the larger size facilities, which is what is in high demand. So if that happens, it could happen faster than we all think. 41 million square feet, which is our ground entitlement, but our clear heights are up to 80 feet. So imagine it's multi-story, so the capacity is more like 120 to 130 million square feet, and it will probably take anywhere from 7 to 10 years.
But so, you used to say 20.
That's the EIR. Okay, the market changes, e-commerce is really upset. People forget that this process is so long that when we started it out years ago, people said, well, you said that in the beginning. The beginning was 5 years ago. So the world has changed. And things have to be updated.
So how will it affect housing development around the area?
So, look, the tide of Moreno Valley is rising. I hope you have your ship in that water. Because when you create, there's no national housing market, because if you have a job in Riverside County, do you care what the housing market is in Orlando, Florida? No. So jobs create demand for housing, and the amount of jobs that we produce as a result of the world of and it will drive a lot of housing. There's approximately 20,000 permanent jobs, 13,000 construction jobs in the process of building it. You're talking apartments, condos, fourplexes, triplexes, homes. Not everybody's going to buy them on the first day, but when you have 20,000 people with jobs, they need to live something.
Thank you, Iddo. You partially answered this. And as an econ major in the past, I love all this macro stuff. On a micro level, and Lance, you may be included in this too. As a realtor, I'm looking at the next year, 2 years, for the growth, if I should be recruiting for my team, and if there is a shift coming, which there was a lot of talk about this past year. And so from my perspective on the ground, where are you guys coming from?
My instinct is slow. What you've been seeing the last couple of years is what you're going to get this year. Next year, the Trump impacts begin to occur, whatever they are, and I agree with what was said by my colleague. We don't know what that's going to be. Fundamentally, it's going to be negative, I suspect, to the economy. Because what I see going on in Congress and what I see coming out of the White House, I think is setting up the potential for the next recession.
Look, there's a pessimism has its virtue. You often, wrong, you're delighted when you're right, if you're wrong, you're happy, it didn't happen. But I think the world does come to an end, we'll go through cycle. It's going to be very location specific. You know, if you're in the Midwest, there might be one impact. If you're in Southern California, another impact. I think what's happening with e-commerce and what a lot of the drivers are out here, we're probably going to be okay. In terms of Trump, I don't think everybody's going to be become stupid on the same day. I think, well, my feeling why he's one is because very simply I understood the American public. If you ask him about his immigration policy, he went to Hillary's website, there's 300 pages with, you know, you pay your taxes, you don't commit crimes, you do this, you go to school, whatever it is, you become nice, you get to be a citizen. 300 pages, nobody reads it. You ask Trump, what's your immigration policy? Throw everybody out, build a wall. I understand that. Doesn't mean it doesn't work, it can't work. It gives very simplified answers. The reality of the world is more complicated, and I think there's enough people around there that are going to somehow get it to be somewhat normalized. But if anybody had precise predictions, might would be.
Well, actually, Trump just sent a tweet. He's demanding a fully investigation into the Highland Fairview project.
We've been there before.
What do you got, Bruce?
I guess if I was in the business of which you're in, which I'm not, okay, I think there's plenty of opportunities. I think you'll have a pretty normal year if you left. Last year was normal. I land on the side of thinking that we'll probably have a recession. But interestingly enough, it probably won't be a really bad one, and it might give the industry a 2% mortgage rate or a mortgage rate that starts with a 2 for a bit. So that some of it would be very active because you would have an enormous amount of refis. You could have permanent benefits come from inside of a 9-month recession. You could have some enormous long-term benefits. So I'm not afraid of our industry for the next couple of years.
Yeah, that's either a double down or a triple down on the 2% interest rates from Bruce. So watch out.
Let me ask someone smarter than I am.
Yes.
If we have a recession, would the Fed fund rate have to go into negative towards the help?
I don't think it goes. Well, it's not going to go negative.
Okay. Why?
They would have gone there already if they were ever going to do it.
Why? We've been expanding for 7 years. We're at a half, and we have full employment. So how do you not go negative?
Well, they're going to build, but before you get the recession, they will have built the rate up to where they can bring it down.
But see, that's the problem. They can't build it fast enough because then they're going to create it by themselves. That's what I feel.
Well, I don't think raising the interest rate by definition is going to give you a recession.
Okay.
I think the craziness coming out of Washington is going to give you a recession.
Yeah, I agree.
By the way, the capital market, there's so much capital in the world. It's like a commodity, right? You got tons and tons of hay, the price, right, is lower than when you have short supply. There's so much capital chasing real vibe. I think the issue of what might get us into the economy is stagnation in some innovation or stagnation in developing new demand for products. Because if you don't have that, it doesn't matter what the interest rates are or what anything else is. But if there's some hyperinflation by artificial, like you said, pumping money into the economy, then interest rates will rise because you're going to suck out the inflation. But
again, do you think that we're typical to have inflation with our demographics?
I think that the inflation will come about if Trump does what he wants and Congress goes along. If you don't do anything with Social Security, you don't do anything with Medicare, you cut taxes, you expand the military, and you have a massive expansion, infrastructure spending, there's only one way to get there, debt. Debt means I don't pull as much out as I push in. As I said in my slides, if you think of the economy as a balloon, the balloon's pretty well at max. Now you start blowing more air into that thing, it can only move a little bit, and price is the only thing. And that's exactly what the Fed's looking. That's why they're going to raise this one.
Yeah, but they're going to raise what, a quarter?
But they will raise repeatedly. If they start seeing this happen, they have no choice. Now, I'll tell you what's really scary is Trump's going to get at least 3 appointments under the Fed board. Now, that's frightening because that might just release inflation without doing anything about it.
Okay.
All right. Well, since we're literally coming to an end and since I paid for the room, I guess I'll have the last few words here. I think the question is maybe in my wheelhouse, because you guys are number crunchers, and you guys are looking at, and Bruce and all of you guys are charts, and to the degree that you're looking forward, trying to forecast where we're going to be. I'll tell you where I am. I am more confident today than I had been in memory, okay? And I was very confident, quite honestly, in 2006 and 7 and 8 and 9, but I was confident for different reasons. I was confident because I had a very strong business plan, which was geared towards a distressed marketplace, and I happened to be very well positioned in a distressed marketplace to take care of that. Now, since we've been coming out of that distressed market in, you know, 29, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, now I as a practitioner and someone who's, you know, trying to build my business model based upon what's the consumer going to do and what are agents going to do, when I hear talk of the recession, and the numbers and the charts may bear that out, and the cycles may bear that out, although Chris seemed to think a little bit differently. I would love to have a cage match, by the way, with either Bruce and Chris, or did you guys see the video, Dr. Husing's video, poking a little bit of fun at Chris in the promotional video? I enjoyed that as well. But just from a broker owner standpoint, the one thing that I see, which maybe, and I don't mean to put words or interpret what these guys are saying in the wrong way as far as potentially looming recession and bad news, I just see a amount of confidence in the marketplace that I have not seen in an extremely long time. Now, maybe that's misplaced, and I don't just mean from realtors, I mean from consumers. There are consumers out there, and 50 people coming through open houses on a Sunday afternoon in bad weather, okay? I've been doing this a long time. I don't see 50 people coming through open houses. These are all not open houses that have been overly promoted in a fantastic way. It's a typical house with a couple signs in the yard. And frankly, so I was at a CAR meeting last week. Not that CAR is any indication of where things are going, but membership in CAR is up. They're anticipating us to be over 200,000 members again. And we can debate whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. People getting their real estate license, applying on a weekly basis. Who gets the BRE list every Monday morning that comes through? Okay, well, that's us. We get the BRE list every Monday that comes through. The number of people that are applying to take the real estate exam on a weekly basis is anywhere from 20 to 40% higher than it has been year over year. And yet, maybe that's misplaced confidence. Maybe those people are losing jobs elsewhere and think real estate might be a fallback position. But just from a sheer confidence standpoint in the marketplace, whether it's misplaced or not, I haven't seen it. I haven't seen the consumer or generally even the agent in a more confident mindset for February or for March in a very, very long time. And generally, we're not a really happy group in January and February and March. Okay, we tend to get a little happier maybe in April and May, assuming things are going a little bit better. But, you know, considering it's March 7th, well, let's do an unscientific poll. Well, first of all, who's left in the room? Raise your hand if you're a lender or a realtor. Okay, basically everybody. Keep your hand up. Keep your hand up if you feel better. Keep your hand up if you feel better today than you did a year ago.
Better?
Better. Yeah. In other words, do you just feel that you're in a better position business plan wise than you were a year ago? Okay. I think most of us. Well, forget about the politics. And by the way, I think Trump kind of got off easy today. I really expected him to get the shit kicked out of him all. So at any rate,
I hate everybody.
At any rate, I think this is where we'll leave it today. One of the reasons that I put on this event, to be honest with you, is because I'm all about trying to figure out where business is going, how my business plan, how I need to basically answer your question, what the heck do I need to do with my time, energy, and money in the next, you know, 6 months, 24 months, 5 years? And I would pay just to go see these guys. It's cheaper for me to put this on than it is to try to figure out where these guys are going to be. To that degree, we'll continue to do these events and we'll continue to do some business planning. But there's always a market for us, guys. I mean, you look at the business that we as realtors or mortgage folks did a year ago or 2 years ago. My business plan is so different today than what it was even 2 years ago. Certainly different than it was 5 years ago. Hopefully you guys got some value out of this today. I really appreciate these guys. This is the largest, I mean, considering the Q&A, we've lost people because everyone's starving. At any rate, I really want to thank everybody for coming. I want to thank all of our sponsors, thank our panelists, and let's go sell some real estate, guys.